On a perfect night for Big East football, we welcome you to Giant Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey, as the Scarlet Knights get ready to take on the Temple Owls. With that excitement on hand, hi everyone, I'm Pat Scanlon. A good night of college football ahead here on NJN. Big East football, the first Big East Conference game for the Rutgers Scarlet Knights as they take on Temple in what's being billed as a turnpike brawl. Ron Dickerson is upbeat and realistic in his first year as head coach of the Temple Owls. Dickerson faces a major rebuilding job, but he's hoping his Owls will play tough and remain positive as the program goes through some growing pains. Temple is hoping to make its own breaks and move up in the competitive Big East Conference. Rutgers coach Doug Graber's biggest worry is boosting his Knights' fragile confidence after a 31-7 loss at Penn State that shattered the team's undefeated season. RU is hoping that senior quarterback Brian Forte can lead the Knights' attack and avoid the mental mistakes that have stalled the RU scoring machine. Meanwhile, the Knights' vaunted defense must prove itself for a full 60 minutes to spell success. My partner on the telecast, the executive director of the National Football Foundation and College Hall of Fame, Bob Cassiola, alongside. Interesting contest tonight for Rutgers. They have to put behind them that devastating loss at State College and get on the Big East play.
They sure do, but it's a tough game for them, Pat, because people are expecting them to beat Temple and beat them big. And if they don't beat them big, it's not going to be as big a victory as it should be. But I think the Rutgers coaches and the players want to regather themselves tonight, rededicate themselves, because this season is a big one for them, and they just want to come away with a big win and get on with the rest of the season.
For Ron Dickerson and the Temple Owls, they come in off a 66-14 loss to Boston College. Temple can come in, play loose, and hope something happens.
And I think they will, and I think they'll try things, both offensively and defensively. They can try gimmick plays. They can come after the quarterback. They've got nothing to lose here. The big thing for Temple is to make progress, to create tough situations early on, and to stay in this ball game the first half. If they're in the ball game for the first half, anything can happen.
All right, the Rutgers Scarlet Knights and the Temple Owls. Big East football here on NJN, the New Jersey Channel.
Is proud to host one of college football's traditional rivalries, the Army-Navy game on December 4th. It's the 94th renewal of the rivalry between the Cadets and Middies, back at Giant Stadium for the second time in 5 years. Army won last year's battle 25-24, but after 102 years, the series is even at 43-43-7. For more information on the 94th Army-Navy game, call 201-935-3900.
A 30% cut, that's the Whitman plan for taxes. But in the 4th District Senate race, both candidates take issue with her proposal.
I think that I owe it to my constituents to make sure that I study the budget that's presented next year before I can guarantee any tax cuts.
You can't run around and promise tax cuts when we have no plan. And that's basically what is happening.
Join Larry Stupnagel as Senator John Mathewson and his opponent Ben Lynch go on the record Friday at 8, Sunday at 12:30.
The Temple Owls and the Rutgers Scarlet Knights. Coming your way on NJN's College Football 93. The Scarlet Knight on hand here at Giant Stadium as Rutgers tries to improve to 3-0 at their home away from home, Giant Stadium. Earlier, I talked with Rutgers head coach Doug Graber about getting that Big East Conference feeling now that conference play is getting underway for the Knights.
I think that, this is really the first true year for the Big East Conference, really, where everybody plays each other, and the games have so much meaning, and And I think that we're starting to get that feel, and as the season progresses, I think we certainly will have it.
Well, they'd like to get that intensity tonight here at Giant Stadium. Bob, Doug Graber at 2-1 right now. What about the keys for him tonight?
He's got some very important ones. One is to reestablish themselves with authority tonight. They've got to come out and rededicate themselves to this season which is going to be a big one for them. They've got to get their tailbacks in the ball game, running the ball, particularly early. They've got to get the balls in the hands of Presley and Willis, and they've got to throw the ball upfield, not up the sidelines, but in the middle where they've got 10, 15, 18-yard passes. They've got to get the ball upfield with the pass.
Ron Dickerson and the Temple Owls come in at 1-2, 0-1 in Big East play. Bob, what about Dickerson and company?
Dickerson's got all his hands full. He's building a program. Tonight, he's got to get his running game going. Why? To keep the ball away from Rutgers so he can stay in this game early. If he can stay in the game early, anything can happen in the second half. But most of all, he's got to improve his special teams play. It's killed him all season long.
All right. Let's go down on the sidelines now, a much drier sideline, and join the third member of our NJN team, former Giant defensive back, Mike Mayock. Mike?
Thanks, Patrick. Last Saturday night, with 4 minutes left in the game and Rutgers trailing Penn State by a score of 31-0, defensive coordinator Rich Rachel decided he had had enough. So while the rain continued to pour and the clock continued to wind down, Coach Rachel found each and every defensive senior for a little heart-to-heart. His message was simple. He said, listen, fellas, the Penn State loss is a tough one, but it's a non-conference loss. It's time to refocus our attention and our attitudes towards Temple and the Big East schedule. Our last eight games, seven of them are in the conference. And with the Big East and the bowl coalition, Big East teams are guaranteed three bowl spots this year. So his message was, listen, it's time to gear it up, refocus our attention. Senior leadership is critical, and we expect to see a huge effort against Temple this week.
All right, Michael. Ron Dickerson, a 1971 graduate of Kansas State in his first year at Temple, 45 years old, coming to Temple from the Clemson program, the former defensive coordinator. And a big factor tonight for the Scarlet Knights, a new quarterback, Brian Forte, replacing Ray Lucas. Forte coming in, 11 of 18, three touchdown passes through the air, one rushing touchdown for Forte. And Bob, it was tough to keep him on the sidelines as well as he was playing.
It was a tough decision, but as they said right from the beginning, Stan Parrish and head coach Doug Graber, both quarterbacks were close. They have no fear of using either one. Forte deserves the chance, and he's going to have that opportunity tonight.
Well, head coach Doug Graber will get a chance to put his offense on the field first. The Scarlet Knights will receive and defend the west end zone. Temple Owls getting set to kick off. This is number 34, David McLaughlin. And back to receive for the Scarlet Knights, Terrell Willis, number 31, and Bill Bailey, the senior, who originally made the Scarlet Knight team as a walk-on. So he and Willis back to receive. And the ball falling off the kicking tee, so McLaughlin will set it up again. Special teams, of course, a big factor tonight. Remember, Terrell Willis with a 75-yard kickoff return against Penn State. Specialty teams, a downfall for Temple. They've already allowed one kickoff to be returned for a touchdown this year. McLaughlin's kick is short. Handled on the 21 and downed there. So Brian Forte, as Tim Pernetti fields the kickoff, Scarlet Knights take over for the senior from East Brunswick, New Jersey, first and 10 from the RU 23-yard line. Bob, what type of an emotional lift will it be for the Scarlet Knights with Forte getting his first start of 1993?
I am sure this has been talked out with the players, by the coaches. These guys are all behind him. They want him to succeed, and they want to win this football game.
The Scarlet Knights begin in with Bailey and Presley, the running backs. And they'll hand off to Presley. And Presley, he gain 7 yards on first down before John Swift, the inside linebacker, makes the tackle. Up front at center for Rutgers this week, it's Kareem Williams replacing John Weiss, who's out with a knee injury. Forte, Bailey, Presley, the backs, Chris Brantley, Marco Battaglia at tight end, and Mario Henry at split end. Second and three from the Rutgers 30. A pitch to Presley. First down, Rutgers out to the 36-yard line. Alshamon Singleton, number 94, makes the stop for Temple.
And there's the defense, the four down linemen. Holland inside, along with Sean Carden at the nose tackle. They're the key guys there, trying to hold up the inside. Terry Swift, the freshman who's starting, he's going to be tested inside. Singleton, outstanding outside linebacker, and the secondary led by Keno Cox at free safety and Kyle Glasper, co-captain at cornerback.
Temple has been suffering from a flu bug, and a number of starters are out tonight due to the flu. Here's Presley, third straight carry, and he barely gets back to the line of scrimmage. Somebody lost a helmet in there. It's Bill Bailey. Lance Johnstone, who didn't start, the sophomore from Philadelphia, number 54, who might be their best athlete on that Temple defense, making the play there. So Johnstone, not expected to start, bothered by the flu beforehand. Second down, lost a one on that play. It'll be second and 11 from the 36. Henry to the right, Brantley to the left. Straight drop for Forte. They screen to Presley. Presley. What a block by Chris Brantley downfield. And Presley knocked out of bounds at the 22-yard line. Lance Johnstone runs him out, but there's a flag back in the vicinity of the 40-yard line.
Great execution. This is the screen pass. Drop back action. Forte Moore, the pocket passer, stays in there, and he's going to drop it off to his tailback to the left of the, to the right of the screen. That's 44 Presley as he drops it off to him. We're going to see this thing come back, unfortunately. And he gets behind his blockers, and he is up and off to the races. They want to get the ball in the hands of their tailbacks tonight, both running and passing the football. You're going to see more of that as the evening wears on. And let's see the official here tell us what's going on.
Referee Tom Thamert saying illegal use of the hands called on the Scarlet Knights. So they go from the Temple 22-yard line back to second and 16 on the Rutgers 31. So Ron Dickerson gets a break there. And the Knights at Brantley to the right, Henry to the left. They run the draw to Terrell Willis. Brantley throws another big block, and Willis cuts it outside. Terrell Willis breaks two tackles and is finally hauled down again back at the Temple 22. Evans Charles and Kyle Glasper make the snap. 47 yards on the game for Willis.
Draw play last week against Penn State. This redshirt freshman averages 6.6 yards against Penn State. Beautiful execution, good block on the top of the screen by Catano, the tight end. And here comes Willis as he gets upfield. And look at the size and the speed as he takes out Glasper, the cornerback, with just an inside fake and gets it all back in one run. Two dynamic running backs in Presley and Willis.
The redshirt freshman from Orange, New Jersey, first and 10, the 22-yard line. Forte drops the ball. And I believe Temple has recovered. Let's see. Bob, it looked like Forte got the ball a little bit earlier than he anticipated. And Tom Thamert saying that Rutgers has recovered. Tim Pernetti with a very important recovery for the Scarlet Knights. But here we go again. Last week against Penn State, mental mistakes, errors took them out of a number of scoring opportunities. Rutgers right now with a penalty and now a botched snap.
That looked to me like the cadence was a little mixed up, that somebody moved before the snap, and it really was the quarterback, and when he finally went back to get the ball, he never had control of it. But fortunately for Rutgers, they got possession back.
Second and 30 for the 42. Presley in motion. Forte. To Marco Battaglia. Battaglia steps out at the 17-yard line, driven out by Keno Cox. Let's go back to the play where the miscue happened, Bob.
Now watch the movement here. You'll see him. He steps up. The ball is snapped. Nobody else is moving. And now he's confused. The play is busted. And he gets hit on the corner here by Johnstone, the defensive end. And the ball is coughed up. Fortunately, they recovered. They got a big play out of Marco Battaglia and an excellent job that time on this play by Forte, who was in trouble. One thing about Forte, he's got experience and he's awareness of where he's going, and that time he dumped it off to his tight end for a big game.
Third and five now on the 17. Forte, triple receivers to the left. Plenty of time, flag flies in the flat. Forte throws it away, almost threw it to the temple high. It was intended for Marco Battaglia. Wow, this is a Rutgers offensive line that has not allowed a sack, but they're called here for holding.
A little different cadence, a little bit of different tempo. That could be part of it, getting adjusted to Forte under these circumstances. That's part of it. Let's see what the call is going to be by the referee.
Holding, offense, refuse, fourth down.
Okay, Temple's going to refuse that and either force them to go for the 3 points here or go for it on fourth down.
And John Benestad is sent onto the field by Doug Graber. So the field goal team is on. Graber has seen his team make some big plays and some mistakes on his first drive. Forte will hold for Benestad, who had a long field goal of 55 yards against West Virginia here at Giant Stadium. This one will be a 34-yard attempt. Benestad 1 for 2 this year. It's blocked by Robert McWilliams. And recovered by Temple's Mike Williams, a defensive back. So Robert McWilliams gets in and blocks the field goal attempt.
I think there's a couple of things happening here. Of course, the special teams hurt him badly last week against Penn State. But watch this. The ball, watch the holder trying to set the ball down. This is Forte. It wasn't a smooth touchdown as far as putting the ball down. There's a little delay there, and it looked like the right side, somebody came clean and got right across the face of the kicker.
So Temple will take over first and 10 on their 17-yard line. Phil Lang at quarterback, number 8, a junior from Brooklyn, New York. And he'll go right back to pass. Across the middle, incomplete. Mark Baxter had it and dropped it. There's your Temple offensive line. Trey Johnson, number 67 at left tackle, is an All-America candidate. Andrew Peterson getting a start for Dean Shoulders. Phil Lang at quarterback, Morse, and Ralphie L. Mack, the tailback. Karyanis at tight end. Baxter and Israel, the wide receivers. There's Trey Johnson, 300 pounds worth. Lang sacked by Andrew Beckett. And Bob, that's a matchup that's been much anticipated. Andrew Beckett against Trey Johnson.
Beckett, of course, with 3 sacks coming into this season, to this game this season, the leading sacker on this Rutgers team. Watch it here. Watch the pressure from this drop back action by the quarterback. Watch 98 come inside the block of number 67, Trey Johnson, who sort of releases him like somebody else is going to pick up on him, but nobody did. Big play defensively for Rutgers.
Loss of 10 on the play, 3rd and 20. Temple operating from their 7-yard line. Here comes the blitz. Flag flies, Lang gets away. It is complete to Ramondo Davidson. But Rutgers had the blitz on.
This penalty is gonna go against Temple, and it'll be a question whether Rutgers wants him to kick here as you see the hold, or whether he wants him to do it again. You're gonna have these situations when you got a quarterback like Lang who's trying to scramble out of that pocket, run around all the time. He's either gonna make big plays for you or he's gonna drive you up a tree. That's what he's gonna do because he is he's all over the place.
George Stewart. Rutgers defensive captain.
They want to refuse it. They want him to punt, get the ball.
There's Rutgers defensive coordinator Rich Rachel. No
holding,
doubt about it.
Offense, penalty refused, fourth down.
Holding against Temple.
So Temple, who had punts blocked and one return for a touchdown by Boston College, sends John Shea onto the field. Fourth and 11 from the 16-yard line. Chris Brantley back to receive for Rutgers right about midfield. Shea gets it away, and it's a good one. Backing Brantley up to the 40. Chris Brantley to the 45, darts down to the 42-yard line. So Brantley, who had two returns for 9 yards, rips off a 25-yard return, 18-yard return off the 44-yard punt by John Shea.
Brantley is such an outstanding player.
We'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium. We're scoreless here in the first quarter.
Special guests Roger Daltrey and Nancy Griffith, Sunday at 4:30.
I like NJN because NJN is New Jersey Sports Channel.
Because it's our hometown network.
It covers everything about New Jersey.
That's the New Jersey Channel.
NJN, New Jersey's own public television.
Controversial testimony before a legislative committee in Trenton today over a measure that would require educators to stress abstinence.
What does that say to your colleagues who genuinely believe that citizens of New Jersey have a constitutional right to carry these guns?
Well, that's why I asked for a vote on Monday.
Now, Atlantic City, Atlantic County have both declared a state of emergency. In Brigantine, there's been a limited state of emergency declared. We heard the governor earlier mention that the National Guard has been called out.
Garland Knights take over, first and 10 on the 42. NJN's College Football 93, Brian Forte at quarterback as he sends Funderburk and Walker wide to the left. Bailey and Presley, the running backs. Here's Bruce Presley. Leaps ahead, down to the 40, and another flag on the play.
You're going to get another hold call. That's the umpire throwing the flag.
Holding Rutgers.
This is tough. You want to get off to a good start. We talked about Rutgers getting themselves their momentum going, new quarterback starting in there, Forte, and lots of mistakes early in this first quarter. Part of it is maybe being unsettled. And as we know, Brian Forte in his career at Rutgers is a slow starter. He comes on strong, and they're off to a slow start right now.
Although Bob, as a reliever this year as a senior, he's come into the game and hasn't had much time to warm up and
right.
In a different role. Has demonstrated the ability to get it going. So that's why he's starting over Ray Lucas. And Lucas, who has played well at times. Forte coming on in relief at Penn State, scoring on a 22-yard touchdown run. Scott Knight's only touchdown of the evening. First and 20 from their own 48 as Presley comes in motion. Forte pumps once. Incomplete, intended for Marco Battaglia, the tight end, who was seeking an open area in the middle of the field for the Scarlet Knights. And that's a play where Battaglia has the option of finding the seam, Bob.
That's right. That's an option pass to the tight end. He looks for the seam. That time he was well covered by Singleton, the outside linebacker, the freshman out of Irvington, New Jersey. He's a terrific prospect, number 94. And he was right there in front of him, blocked him off from catching that ball. You're looking at Singleton.
Alshamon Singleton. 6'3", 225. Forte. Pressure coming. And Forte will get out of bounds.
That'll be a flag.
And T. Lang Lloyd, a freshman from Willingboro. Knocked Forte out of bounds, and a flag has flown over on the far sideline.
They tried to screen that time. They were setting up the screen, as you see this. Temple really smelled it out, and they weren't about to give him that screen pass. And now Forte, looking under pressure, doesn't throw it up for grabs. That's important. Decides to take it out of bounds, and you see the freshman Lloyd giving him that shove out of bounds. He makes a big play to contain him, and a foolish play at the end that gives Rutgers terrific field position.
Personal foul. Offense, defense. Automatic first down.
And that's what happens when you got a young team, an inexperienced team, and you're not winning. You make those kind of mistakes. You've got to overcome them. And that's the hardest thing when you're trying to build a program, as is the case here today.
Well, Forte, fortunately, he also tripped over one of the sticks from the marker that the chain gang had not dropped, so it was a tough play for Forte, but he'll hand off to Bruce Presley, and Presley just lowers his head and gets down to the Temple 30-yard line.
You know, Pat, you mentioned earlier there's a situation developing inside with Kareem Williams, number 50, the junior out of Philadelphia, who's starting at center today because of the injury to John Bleich. And that time they ran a little draw action, and Williams opened up that middle, did a good job of giving tailback Bruce Presley a chance to run up in there and pick up 8 yards.
Four carries already as we look at center Kareem Williams. Four carries for Bruce Presley. Now Forte. Looking downfield, Eddie Walker. Incomplete. It was nearly intercepted by Robert McWilliams, and Forte took a lick.
Going to his left that time, Brian Forte really was looking in the flat to deliver the football. Good coverage by Temple. Then he decided to go deep. He saw Eddie Walker deep, but as he's going to his left, being a right-handed quarterback, he couldn't get anything on the ball. He was lucky that that guy there, number 22, McWilliams, did not come up with the interception.
Robert McWilliams, a sophomore from Miami, Florida. And now Forte looking at third and two. Henry split to the right, Brantley to the left. And Lance Avina seeing some action. There's a pass batted down by Tim Terry, number 36, a redshirt freshman from Hempstead, New York.
Just trying to get the first down, a little sideline cut by the wide receiver. Watch number 36 at the top of the screen here. Just drop back action by Forte. 36 on the top of the screen. Reads it, gets his hands up, and knocks it back in his face. Big play by Terry.
Tim Terry, All-State and a National Honor Society student from Hempstead, New York. John Benestad on to attempt the field goal for the Scarlet Knights. A 49-yard attempt. It's up. And it is wide right. So Benestad. No good. And we're still scoreless with 9:13 left in the first quarter. Temple and Rutgers. It's a stalemate.
Join the new Rutgers Kids Club and receive free tickets.
I'm Richard Lindley. I'll be bringing you the ITN World News with the top stories from ITN's own correspondents round the globe.
Michael Brunson, ITN, Westminster.
Houston.
In the city.
With the Arara tribe in the Amazon.
In the Black Sea. Off the Piper Alpha platform in the North Sea.
Robert Moore, ITN, Baghdad.
Loch Ness.
And a French insurance story which...
At ITN's new London headquarters, a special editorial team deals exclusively with ITN World News. They assess the reports filed by ITN's correspondents for their importance to the world audience.
1-0.
In ITN World News, you'll find the stories that matter dealt with in depth. And in our daily special reports, we'll cover an aspect of the news development to give you the full picture. Monday to Friday, the ITN World News.
Exclusively here on NJN, weeknights at 11:30.
You're watching NJN, the New Jersey Channel. WNJS, Camden.
Temple from the I formation. And they hand off to the fullback, Sidney Morse, out of Elkins Park, Pennsylvania. Jameel Jackson on the tackle. Here's a good look at Phil Lang, transferred to Temple from Nassau Community College.
He's a good guy. He's a good athlete. He's got some ability. The trouble is he's got a little bit of a windup whenever he delivers the ball. He sort of takes a little longer and therefore gets himself in trouble at times.
Temple operates from the I formation. Rafael Mack is the tailback. Lang. Completed midfield. They like to spread the ball around. And that's Tim Israel at wide receiver making the reception. Israel wearing number 15 this week.
You look at Keith Bryant, Guarnera, and nose tackle. They've got to find a nose tackle, Rutgers said, and they're hopeful that Jim Guarnera will come around. Beckett, of course, Swartz, who had a big game last week against Penn State, Jaleel Jackson, George Stewart, who plays hurt and plays well, and Sneathan at the outside linebacker position. Of course, the question mark of the cornerbacks. Keith Price has been hurt. Michael Roberts has been playing well, but he's only a redshirt freshman. And, of course, Bellamy and Jackson have to come through tonight. They're the big hitters in that secondary.
Holding, though, backs up the play. Second and 23 for Temple. They'll send double receivers to the right. And Ramondo Davidson to the left. This is Baxter in motion. Lang quickly to Ramondo Davidson, who made a nice catch and gets out of bounds at the 29-yard line. Smith in the coverage.
This is a great pass. Watch the quarterback come out here, and he's going to hit in the flat to the right side of the screen. Ramondo Davis, number 11, who comes back to the football. Let's see if he keeps himself in bounds. Good delivery, low to the outside. Great catch. Great catch by Davis.
That's Mike Fulman, number 27, the redshirt freshman playing in the corner. Third and 11, Lang, straight drop. He whistles a bullet to Tim Israel.
The officials now have to decide. They say he caught the ball, and I think he did. I don't think there's any question about it. What a great pass again. Again, we're talking about a quarterback, Lang, who comes out of Nassau Community College. He comes in here, and he's the starter. He's got a lot of movement. He's a very good natural athlete, and that time he gunned that ball in from Brooklyn, New York, the junior. He gunned that ball into the wide receiver, a big catch, and a first down for Temple.
Phil Lang, who has been sacked 10 times in this young season. First and 10 for the Temple 44. They hand off to Morris, and Sidney Morris is tackled in the backfield. Keith Bryant and Andrew Beckett combining. Andrew Beckett, the senior out of Barrington and Haddon Heights High School. Andrew Beckett, who played well against Penn State on the season, now has four sacks, and is quite excited about playing against Trey Johnson, who's a, Trey Johnson, of course, a Lombardi Award nominee. Second and 11. Baxter in motion. And Lang stood up by Bobby Sneathan. The pass is incomplete, intended for Baxter, but Rutgers, Bob, is getting more pressure than we've seen all season.
As we watch it from this sideline shot, you're coming out to the left side. There's 89. There's Sneathan. Sneathan gets brought down, still continues. Great effort, second effort. Finally lassos the quarterback, but this kid's going to throw the ball no matter what happens. And that time, he tried to get it to his wide receiver. Big play by Sneathan. Sneathan's had a very good season thus far. Eight solo tackles coming into this game.
Three wide receivers for Temple. Lang, quarterback draw. First down, Temple. Phil Lang on the quarterback draw gets down to the Rutgers 39-yard line before Malik Jackson made the stop.
We said early on they want to stay in this game early, and they're doing it both defensively and now offensively. This is a design quarterback draw. He just makes the play. 56 Stewart gets blocked, and he gets downfield. Remember, Phil Lang is 6'2", 218 pounds. So he's got some size and some speed behind him. We said he's a natural athlete, and that he's been doing so far.
He picked up 18 yards on the play. First and 10 in Rutgers territory. Lang taking his time and sandwiched after a gain of two. Andrew Beckett and Rusty Swartz right there for the Scarlet Knights, along with Jameel Jackson.
Bob Sneathan made a big play too. He was working against that offensive tackle on the left side, Trey Johnson, all the way, and he continued, pursued the quarterback and got him inside out. Again, with a guy like Lang, who can move around, who's got a lot of maneuverability, puts a lot of pressure on your defense and really tires you out trying to chase him down.
Doug Graber looking on, hoping his Knights will remain patient. That defense can settle down. Lang setting up a screen, chased he just throws it away.
Excellent job that time by Jameel Jackson, the linebacker, who came over and smelled that thing out along with Granera, the nose tackle.
The flag on the play. Here's the call from Tom Thamert. Ineligible receiver downfield. So as Lang was waiting and waiting, Ron Dickerson sees his offense make the mistake.
Well, the question is, will Rutgers push him back or take this, refuse this penalty and make it a third down?
Ineligible receiver downfield on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Field position, they're pushing him back.
Now Rutgers makes a defensive substitution into the ball game. Mark Washington, number 23, and Brian Sheridan, number 54. Bob Rich Rachel, a defensive coordinator for the Scarlet Knights, told us they're going to come with a dime package, six defensive backs on second and long, third and long situations.
Watch this. We've got four down linemen, and they're going to drop off and defend with six unless they decide to bring their outside linebackers.
Lang pitching to Mack. Mack bobbles and is dropped for a loss. Malik Jackson in the backfield had that play diagnosed as he brings down Ralphiel Mack, a loss of nine.
That time they tried to run the option, they anticipated man coverage, they were just to run him off. As you look at this defense now, you're going to end up with one, two, three, four, five, six defenders in the game because they're playing pass and rush with the outside. That time they decided to run the football and run option, figuring these people would be run off, but he never made the pitch. We'll see more of that in obvious passing situations. Six defensive backs.
Third and 22, Lang on a straight drop. And he is dropped. Number 54, Brian Sheridan, the much-heralded freshman from Union, New Jersey, making the play. Last year's Gatorade Player of the Year in New Jersey.
They've got to come after him. Watch this as we watch number 54 get into the play. Sheridan, as he comes up late, he smells things out. Now he sees the football. He realizes Lang's in trouble, and he comes to make the finishing touches. He's going to be an outstanding football player.
Fourth and 27. Here comes the pressure. The punt away by John Shea. And Brantley decides to field it on the 14-yard line. Here's Brantley. Out to the 32-yard line. So Brantley letting it bounce. And driven out by Frank Carter. 42-yard punt. Doug Graber, the Scarlet Knights are scoreless with 4:08 left here in the first quarter.
WNJS, Camden.
Feel the power of gospel Sunday at 5:30.
Hi, Mary Cummings. Noted defense attorney William Kunstler is our guest next time on New Jersey Tonight. He's representing Sheikh Omar Abdelrahman. He's charged with leading 14 of his followers in a war of urban terrorism against the United States, a war which allegedly includes the bombing of the World Trade Center and the murder of Rabbi Meir Kahane. The Sheikh and his followers say they are innocent. We talk about it on the next New Jersey Tonight with William Kunstler, only on NJN, the New Jersey Channel.
And welcome back to Giant Stadium. Pat Scanlon, Bob Cassiola, and Mike Mayock here on NJN's College Football 93. And Bob, a bit of a surprise, I think, those goose eggs at this point.
Mistakes. Rutgers hurting themselves offensively with penalties and miscues. Now they've just got to sustain a drive here. Very important for them to get a score real soon.
Rutgers with 72 yards to the ground. And Brian Forte calls timeout. Rutgers outgaining Temple almost 2-1, but and a flag thrown out in the left flat. Did the clock expire, Bob?
It's hard to believe it could have expired. I mean, they just turned the ball over. He's saying it's a mistake, and he's
no
putting
flag.
It back. Okay. That's the referee, Tom Thabert.
Bob, you like it when those guys pick up their flags, don't you?
Well, I like when people admit they make mistakes, Matt. Like, you know, Mike Mayock, people like that.
There's Moe's rising. He signals the plays in from Offensive coordinator Stan Parrish. Wow, Florida State continuing along as the number one team in the country.
They dominate you, but here's a big upset. Boston College going up to Syracuse and beating 33-29. Syracuse is struggling right now. This makes for very interesting weeks for Rutgers in the future.
Texas A&M over Texas Tech, 31-6. And Bob, Memphis State, you talked about an improved ball club this year.
Much improved and playing very well.
Well,
as an extra coach right there. Recognize that guy? Notice he bought his hat.
Price tag still on there. Bill Cosby, Temple's biggest fan, giving a little bit of advice to Phil Lang. Meanwhile, Rutgers will begin to operate now. First and 10 from their own 33. Brantley and Henry are split to the left. Eddie Walker to the right. The lone running back is Bruce Presley. And they'll hand off to Presley. And he is very close to a first down. Jeff Coles, number 26, makes the stop for Temple.
Good job on the right side. Scott Vaughn, the right tackle. Spitzer, the right guard, giving him a chance to get upfield and run with the football. Presley came into this game averaging 6.6 yards per carry. And he really adds a great dimension. So far tonight, he's got 5 rushes and 32 yards.
Number 32, Wes Bridges, is in at fullback. And Bridges throws a block on the left corner. That springs Presley for 4 yards down to the 49-yard line. John Swift and Jeff Coles make the tackle. Let's go down now to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Patrick, there's some mixed emotions down here on the Rutgers sidelines. Defensively, they're fairly satisfied. They're flying to the ball. They're making plays. Temple hasn't done anything they haven't expected. However, offensively, they're a little frustrated. Once again, Rutgers is doing nothing but stopping themselves, just like last week against Penn State. Look for a little more intensity on the offensive side.
They need to settle down and reestablish themselves, as Bob talked about. Here's the quick snap. Again, some confusion on the cadence. Forte runs away for his life and completes the pass to Chris Brantley. Robert McWilliams made the play, but Bob, half the line didn't fire on the play.
There's something in the cadence that's confusing, and I got to believe it's with the quarterback, quite frankly. We know that Forte likes to come over, change his inflection in his voice many times to draw people off sides, but sometimes it maybe works against him.
Brian Forte, a senior from East Brunswick, his quarterback rating coming into the game was a gaudy 189.9 based upon his relief efforts earlier in the year. Now facing 3rd and 5. Forte, complete to Mario Henry. First down Rutgers as Henry is brought down by McWilliams.
Nice action by Forte. Good drop back, waited for Mario to come open. You'll see that it's just going to be a drop back action, and he's going to hit the wide receiver in the corner right here. Enough room for the first down. Just in there, good concentration on the part of Mario Henry, and he gets that first down. They've got to put first downs together here.
Robert McWilliams has been an active sophomore from Miami, Florida. Terrell Willis now in a tailback for Rutgers. Here's Willis. Cuts outside. Gets a block from Brantley and picks up just about 9 yards, maybe 10. But Terrell Willis hits that corner, Bob, and people mention the name Dorsett, O.J. Simpson.
It's O.J. He's got those moves of Simpson a lot, his body angle, the way he runs, and how he slips tackles. Just watch him in the flat here, right on that man there. Here's where he slips the tackle. You're not going to arm tackle him. He gets upfield. Now he gets up behind number 12, Brantley, who gets a block for him. And now he's always looking to score a touchdown, as his coach Stan Parry says, which is great. And he's going to score a lot of touchdowns in his career. But what a big back. What a tremendous asset to have the Presley and Willis together in tandem.
He did get the first down. First and 10. Forte looking deep for Brantley. And we've got pass interference. The flag flies. Phil Cox had Brantley by the uniform.
Interesting call here. We said they want to go up top. They want to go deep. They want to get up in the middle of the field. That time Brantley just running a fly pattern, tried to get by the cornerback Cox. And you're going to see the hold here. And you're going to pay for it.
Holding against Temple.
Yeah, because Brantley tried to separate himself and was being held by Cox.
By the defense against an eligible receiver. While the ball was in the air, 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
So Chris Brantley, who has been explosive, the senior from Teaneck, and Phil Cox is a freshman from Flemington, New Jersey, a walk-on out of Hunterdon Central High School, one of two true freshmen who are backup corners on this Temple Owl defense. First and 10 from the 21. Pitch to Willis. He accelerates, stays on his feet, down to the 4-yard line. Terrell Willis. Tim Terry finally brought him down.
Just a toss and he cuts it back inside. Watch the right side here as the hole opens up. Number 77, Scott Vaughn, the big senior, gets a big block for him, and then they just cave the linebacker. And look at the body angle that he runs with. And all you tackle here are shoulder pads. That's what you get when you try to get Terrell Willis. Great acceleration.
First and goal from the Temple 4-yard line. Bridges and Willis, the running backs. Three tight ends for Rutgers, and a flag flies. Fortek to Battaglia, the touchdown. But let's sort it out. There's a flag on the play. Offsides against Temple. Touchdown, Rutgers.
Big play for Rutgers, big play for Brian Forte. Comes off the play action. Fake to the tailback. Everybody's sizing up the tailback. Willis inside, and he comes out off of that fake, and he waits for his tight end, Marco Battaglia, to get in the corner of the end zone and delivers the ball for the score.
So John Benistan, who's had some problems on field goals tonight, on to attempt the extra point out of the hold of Forte. This one splits the uprights. It's good. And so with 1:20 left in the first quarter, Rutgers goes up 7-0.
Here's the touchdown score. Here's your key guy, Battaglia. We're going to get a strong fake to the tailback. He's going to come out of this, eventually go and find his tight end in the corner of the end zone. Remember, many times in these situations, a tight end has to be covered by a linebacker. Here's the play fake. As he comes out of it, Battaglia is wide open on the back end of the end zone, and Forte just puts the ball up for it, makes a very easy catch and a score.
And a heads-up play for Brian Forte in carrying out the play to its fruition because the flag was on Temple. Don't forget, next Sunday, NJN continues College Football 93, a Division III contest in the New Jersey Athletic Conference. Kane and Montclair State. That coming your way next Sunday morning at 8:30 here on NJN. Rick Giancola and the Redhawks of Montclair State. And the Rutgers offense can only hope that those cheerleaders get a workout tonight, Bob.
Yeah.
Rutgers goes 7 plays, 67 yards. It took 248, and Forte to Marco Battaglia. Battaglia's first touchdown catch of the season puts Rutgers up 7-0.
Battaglia did not have a good week last week at Penn State. A couple of crucials that he didn't come up with, but he's worked hard in practice. They've been on his case, and he's really come through. We know what the quality of Battaglia, his size, his speed, his pass-catching ability, his blocking ability. And that was a very rewarding touchdown for a hard week of practice for him.
Fredrickson Atwater back for Temple. Atwater on the 12. Damon Atwater trying to get outside. And Mike Fullman, the freshman, stayed with him, number 27.
So many times you can tell the intensity of a team by their special teams, and that showed up for Rutgers there. He could have easily reversed his field, but they stayed in line. They went after him. And Fullman, who's been under pressure as a redshirt freshman playing cornerback, but one thing he can do, he can run and he can hit, and he's just going to get better. And that special team, he made the big play.
Mike Fullman and Michael Roberts. Doug Graber calls them M1 and M2. A couple of redshirt freshmen. First and 10 from the Temple 19. Late stages of the first quarter. Lang
incomplete, intended for Ramondo Davidson. Ray Lucas, Brian Forte, sharing a nice moment on the sidelines.
It's not an easy situation to try and alternate and give equal time to quarterbacks, but I think these two have handled it as well as anybody possibly could. There's great feeling there, and they're both going to have opportunities as this season progresses.
Offensive coaches told the offensive unit this week, hey, both guys are going to play, both deserve to play. And there's a good play by Mark Washington, who batted away the pass intended for Mark Baxter.
Washington, of course, comes in for that extra defensive back. Once again, Rutgers had six defensive backs on the field. Mark Washington, the sophomore out of Temple Hill, Maryland, made a nice play on the crossing receiver.
Third and 10. Three receivers in for Temple, but they maintain that high formation. Lang stripped from behind. Recovered by Malik Jackson. Touchdown, Rutgers.
Let's see what this flag means. It's a personal foul against Temple. What a great play.
Personal foul against Temple. Touchdown.
Touchdown stands for Doug Graber and the Scarlet Knights.
And those are the things that have to happen. We talked with Rich Rachel, a defensive coordinator. Momentum coming from a defense is really terrific for a team. And that time they made the play. Great pursuit. I believe it was Keith Bryant, number 91, who came from the backside and swatted the ball away. And in full gear, running down the field, it was Schwartz, 59, the other outside
Good
linebacker.
Ball. Personal foul after the touchdown. 15-yard penalty on the succeeding kickoff.
We'll talk about it after this PAT try.
Forte to hold. Benistan on to attempt the point after try. It's good. And the Scarlet Knights go up 14-0 on a defensive touchdown. Rusty Schwartz got the strip, and Malik Jackson cashed it in for six.
The redshirt freshman from Edison, Schwartz, watch the pursuit. Now watch as he's watched from the backside what we're going to get here. And the quarterback is going to end up in this direction, but he's going to track him down all the way to make the play. Comes from the backside, as you'll see, and there's the pursuit. Excuse me, there's 59 right there. There's the swat of it, and 43. In full flight, just bounces right up in his arm. 43 breaks the tackle here, and Jackson, Malik, goes in for the score. Big play by the defense.
A 16-yard touchdown return for the senior from Elizabeth, Malik Jackson. Wow, that is one of the points that Rich Renschel has been looking for. He's been looking for improved play from his seniors, Jackson and Bellamy. And Malik comes up big here in the late stages of the first quarter.
You got to find a way to get fundamentally sound. That's what he said. You got to be tough on defense, get back to the basic fundamentals, playing good position defense.
Hey, that's what I was supposed to play in Washington.
43, Malik Jackson from Elizabeth, New Jersey. Anyway, they're getting those fundamentals back tonight. Good tackling, good hitting, good pursuit, and they come up with a score.
So John Benistad will now have the opportunity, because of the personal foul on Temple, to kick off from the 50-yard line. Bob, that ball's located somewhere around a little bit north of Trenton on the New Jersey map there at center. There we go.
All right.
Benistad drives Fredericks back into the end zone, and Jeff Frederick will down it as Temple takes over. First and 10 from their 20-yard line. Under a minute left here in the first quarter. Now Rich Rachel, the defensive coordinator, has to be happy putting a touchdown on the board.
He's been very happy with his defense, certain particular players, and in particular Rusty Schwartz, the redshirt freshman. He calls him a good rush man, good cover man, and just getting better with every game. He had a very good, strong game last week against Penn State. He comes up with a big play tonight.
Here's the pitch now to Danny Davis. Davis, number 30, in at tailback. And he gets a couple. Clemson today over North Carolina State. Ron Dickerson, of course, the former Clemson defensive coordinator. And in the Big East, Bob.
All right, that's a big one. Here's two high-scoring teams playing to a 14-13 victory at West Virginia. Big win for West Virginia, but Virginia Tech is tough.
And Florida over Mississippi State, 38-24. Well, Phil Lang calls timeout. And I don't believe he's going over to talk to Bill Cosby. Steve Goldman is the quarterback coach. He calls the Temple offensive plays from upstairs. And Nick Gasparato coaches the offensive line and works the sidelines for Dickerson. Don't forget, this Thursday night, the Doug Graber Show moves to 8 o'clock here on NJN. I invite you to join me and head coach Doug Graber as we talk Scarlet Knight football. Of course, Rutgers will recap the Temple game and look ahead to RU's game next Saturday at noon against the Boston College Eagles here at Giant Stadium. That's a big game for Rutgers. As you see, Doug Graber and Ed O'Neill, the special teams coach.
Well, it's always nice when you kick off in the 50, Pat. That relieves a lot of pressure when you got a kicker who can put the ball in the end zone 5 yards and let him start out on the 20.
Temple has managed just 31 total yards so far, a negative 4 yards rushing. Ryan, here comes Rusty Schwartz. And he ran it down. All the way from his left outside linebacker spot, Schwartz makes the play.
And that's somewhat inexperience on the part of Lang, and it tells you what you go through, what Ron Dickerson goes through in trying to put a club together. That time he held the ball too long. He knew there was backside pursuit. He's got to get rid of it, get it out of bounds, take his lumps and get back. Now he's got a third down and about four.
That's what they'll face when the second quarter begins. We've played 15 minutes here at Giant Stadium. The Scarlet Knights lead Temple by 2 touchdowns.
Clean drinking water. We can't live without it. That's why environmentalists are fighting to protect Sterling Forest, New York from development. Crystal clear streams flowing out of the forest cross the state line into northern New Jersey's water supply. But this pristine supply is in jeopardy. Environmentalists warn that fragmenting the forest will destroy the watershed forever. Their overriding concern, preserving pure water.
Thursday at 8:30.
Let the joyous news be spread, the wicked old Christmas at last is dead.
This is incredible.
It's so smart. It's so
Discover New Jersey, Thursday at 9.
This is NJN, the New Jersey Channel. WNJS, Camden.
The Temple Owl has been grounded in the first quarter. Right now, let's go down to Mike Mayock on the sidelines.
Patrick, one of the hot topics of discussion on the Rutgers sidelines right now is the most elemental part of the game. That's the center quarterback exchange. And what we have today is two differences in the lineup. Ryan Forte with a different cadence for Ray Lucas, and Kareem Williams, who's usually a guard, starting at center. The result has been 3 missed snaps already, and they've been talking about it on the sidelines. Apparently, Brian's pulling away too early, but also Kareem has snapped it too early twice. So keep your eye on that, guys.
Very important point, Mike. Very important point you made. It's not only Forte and his cadence, but you got a new center. They haven't worked that much together. Very tricky.
Temple now with a one-back set on 3rd and 4. And it's complete across the middle. Tim Israel picks up the first down.
That was a big pass. Big pass on the part of Phil Lang. Big catch by Israel. They were playing man coverage. He concentrated on the football, and number eight Lang got him the ball. That's a tough first down, but they got it to keep this drive alive.
Malik Jackson and Andrew Beckett on the play. But not before Temple gets a first down out to their 32-yard line. This time it's Davidson to the right. Israel and Baxton to the top of the screen. Here's the draw to Raphael Mack. And Mack is tackled after a gain of three. George Stewart and Swartz on the tackle.
Coming into this game, Rich Rachel, the defensive coordinator for Rutgers, mentioned that when you look at Temple's offensive line, they're huge. You go from left to right, Trey Johnson, 300, Pagan, the left guard, 324, the center. Summer Day, 282. The right guard is 289. The right tackle is 320. They're enormous.
Now that time it looked like Jim Guarnera, the Rutgers nose tackle, is drawn offsides. Jim Guarnera is crucial to this Rutgers defense as he draws the offsides play and Rashad Swinger comes in. Rutgers is looking for play from the nose tackle spot, and Guarnera and Rashad Swinger are competing at that spot. Crucial to the type of defensive scheme they're trying to play, Bob.
Offsides, defense, first down.
Guarnera is quick. Guarnera is active, but that's a mistake he should never make. He's looking right at the center. He goes on movement. You don't jump on sound. He's right over the ball. But that's the kind of experience he needs. He's only a sophomore. He's a good prospect. But you're right. They've got to find a nose tackle to play this pro defense. If you don't have a nose tackle, you got problems.
Playing a 3-4 scheme. Temple from the I formation. Lang throws it out. It's complete again to Tim Israel, the sophomore from Lawnside, New Jersey. And he's tackled by Keith Price.
If you look at this, this is well delivered by number eight Lang as he drops back here and he just hits Israel. He's reading zone coverage. And when you see this setup, you'll see as we're looking at this, look at the cushion here by the cornerback. So he's just going to drop back and deliver the football to him. He's going to be wide open on the sideline for a pickup of about 7 yards.
Lang has a gun. He gets it out there in a hurry. Now here's Lang winding up, looking for Israel. Incomplete off the hands of Israel. He had beaten the Rutgers defense. Price and Bellamy were in the vicinity, but Israel, if he hauls it in, had the reception.
Hey, this is tough. He flattens himself out here as you watch it. Israel be on the left side of the screen as you see the quarterback Lang drop back, make a fake into 30. His tailback gets away from the pressure and then delivers the football. And he's beaten number 45, Keith Price, who's had his problems this year with injuries, we know, with a knee. But that time he was well behind him, just a little bit too far.
Lang threw that ball almost 60 yards in the air. Israel did well to get his hands on it. Lang with a wild pitch. Who's got it? Rutgers. Rusty Swartz recovers. Phil Lang was pitching to Danny Davis and Rutgers pressure collapsed the play, Bob.
Watch this play as it comes right down the line to the right side. You're going to see it here. He's going to work down. He fakes to the fullback. It's almost like the old freeze option at Syracuse runs, but he gets tangled up there. Now when he pitches the ball, it's behind his trailback, number 30, Davis. And watch 59, Swartz. He's all over the place coming up with that ball. Great field position for Rutgers. The defense again on the spot.
Steve Swartz, the redshirt freshman, gives Rutgers the ball back at the Temple 44-yard line. Willis goes in motion and Forte drops straight back. Forte, flush from the pocket, picks up 9 yards on the scramble. Checking stats from the first quarter.
The key, of course, is the Rutgers, of course, with a far more rushing yardage here. Temple with no yards rushing, 35 total. Tough to win football games when you do that. But the defense is playing well. They're coming alive for Rutgers. And offensively, we're starting to see Brian Forte now getting into the rhythm of this football game. That time he scrambled. There was nobody there. He picked up 6 yards.
They'll deploy Henry to the left, Brantley to the right. Here's Terrell Willis. Willis. An another spectacular run. Willis jukes down to the 2, make it the 1 yard line, a gain of 36 yards. He is electric.
He's electric, Pat, and he's got great change of pace, great moves, but let me tell you, look inside and watch the blocking inside here. He is 8 yards deep, practically. Watch the block by the center, Williams, on the nose tackle, number 73, Wentzel, a defensive tackle, and that's the cut. Only the great ones make those kind of cuts. Again, look at him change the speed, fake out number 22 as he goes by McWilliams, and the ball sitting on the 2 yard line.
Now Rutgers goes with its 3 tight end set. Battaglia in motion. Presley. Up and over for his first touchdown of the year. Bruce Presley. Hard to believe Bruce Presley scoring just his first score of the year. But the Knights go up 20-0. Now John Benestad on to attempt the extra point. Brian Forte to hold. It's good. So with 13-12 to play here in the second quarter, Rutgers leading 21-0.
This is a goal line play. They're just going to get the ball to Presley deep. Good surge by that offensive line. As you can see, they drive into that end zone, and then Presley gets up and over and crosses the plane. Good looking play by the entire offensive line. That's what does it for us.
We'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium. Bruce Presley talking it over with the coaches upstairs.
Join world-renowned chef Jacques Pepin when he returns for an all-new season of Today's Gourmet. In 26 episodes, Jacques prepares light, healthy menus for a modern lifestyle and creates a feast for the eye as well. His mouth-watering recipes are low in fat but full of flavor. Eggplant and red pepper terrine, layered with brie cheese and bathed in fresh tomatoes. Red snapper poached in white wine, surrounded by vegetables. The favorite Sunday dinner of the President of France, Jacques' special leg of lamb. And a simple, elegant souffle of apricot puree and fig. Jacques demonstrates and demystifies traditional techniques for the home chef and updates classic dishes, bringing you on a culinary adventure of foods and flavors from all over the world.
So join me, Jacques Pepin, for the new season of Today's Gourmet. Happy cooking!
That's weeknights at 5:30 on the New Jersey Channel.
We welcome you back to Giant Stadium. Rutgers has jumped up 21-0 over Temple. Rutgers going 44 yards in 3 plays. Terrell Willis, the key. Bruce Presley finished it off with a 2-yard score. Just 19 seconds after that Temple fumble was recovered by Rusty Swartz.
And that's what you want to do. Get those kind of turnovers from your defense and go right after. But the big play, either the pass or the run in that particular case by Terrell Willis, put it all together.
Benestad to kick off. We'll chase Jeff Frederick back into the end zone. And Frederick's going to come out and get out to the 17-yard line. Sean Smith and Mark Washington make the tackle. Well, Ron Dickerson said, no one expects a miracle. Everyone has been very realistic about what we're trying to do. 50 of 101 players on the Temple roster, Bob, are first-year players, either true freshmen or redshirt freshmen.
Well, he's going to keep it together. He has a project. He's a guy who has paid his dues, though, to become a head coach. Believe me, he's been a lot of places. And he's earned every right to be a head coach.
Raphael Mack, who Dickerson calls a smart runner, played in 22 games. Now a junior from Trenton Central High School, brought down by Stewart and Swartz. Mack's the type of runner who reads the play well, not blinding speed, but 5'11", 205, and he picks up 8 yards. There's the pass batted away by Bob Sneathan.
Interesting call defensively that time. Sneathan, who usually is coming, they turn him loose, put pressure on from that linebacker position, was flying to the flat to get underneath the pass, and he did it beautifully. Just the way the defensive coordinator wants to do it, he picks up here, and he comes out in that flat. You'll see him move to the flat, get underneath this. There he is to make the hit. Beautiful job.
That'll set up third and two. Here's the pitch to Davis. George Stewart met him on the left corner. And I don't believe he got the first down.
Once again, Sneathan make the play. This time, instead of dropping into the flat, he was coming hard. And by coming hard, as you watch this, you'll see on the opposite side, they're going to toss the ball. 89, Sneathan's going to get in the backfield. Enough time for now 56, the linebacker, Stewart, to get over there to make the hit. And that's what stopped the play and forces Temple to once again punt the football.
John Shea, who's averaging 43 and a half yards a punt, is back for Temple. Let's see, it looks like we have a piece of equipment down around the 29-yard line.
I think more than that, they may not have enough people on the field, and the head coach saw that and called timeout. That was part of it. They've had their problems with the kicking game. You discussed it early on. Punt blocks, punt returns. And now number 22 is coming into the game, and he was they didn't have enough people on the field.
You're right, Bob, they had 10.
Now the head coach goes over and checks it out with his specialty teams coach to make sure that's the responsibility.
And Doug Graber can hope that his team can take advantage of another good punt return from Chris Brantley, who's back around the 40-yard line.
Doug Graber wanted to come into this game and go back and have a good, solid win. Everybody expects Rutgers to win this football game, but he needs a solid win to recoup, get these players back together and on the same goals they had set for themselves in preseason, because there's so many big games left for Rutgers. So it's important for them to keep the pressure on themselves all night long.
Shea, who had 4 punts blocked by Boston College, back around the 12-yard line of Temple. Gets it away, and Brantley will watch it bounce. It rolls dead at the Rutgers 31-yard line. A 44-yard punt. Bob, we've talked about the problems that Temple has had on special teams, and illustrated very well here.
Kickoff return TD, punt return for TD, 3 blocked punts coming into this game. I mean, that sort of stuff kills you, particularly if you're not a good football team, because that puts you in a tougher position to ever want to win a game, and that's what they've got to work on.
Ray Lucas now at quarterback for the Scarlet Knights. So Rutgers up 21-0, and offensive coordinator Stan Parrish has said that both these quarterbacks are good, both are going to play, and immediately they go to Lucas here in the second quarter. He begins by handing off to Terrell Willis.
What this does for you defensively now, Temple's got to maybe think a little bit differently. Lucas is a sprint out. He's a play action. He's a scrambler. Forte's going to be in the pocket. Now you might see a different type of offense, put new pressure on it. Ray Lucas, the sophomore out of Harrison, New Jersey.
Reggie Funderburk and Eddie Walker split to the right. Bailey and Willis are the running backs. 2nd and 8. And there you go, Bob. He sprints out. He completes it to Walker. Walker turns up field and picks up a Rutgers first down.
That's what he does so well. On the run, throwing the football. Good job by Walker, the sophomore to Woodbury High School. Watch the sprint on the right side. It's pure sprint all the way. Good block in the corner. He gets the block from the fullback, of course. We have a reliable Bill Bailey. He gets the ball out in the flat. Gives Walker a chance to turn upfield and get the first down.
Eddie Walker, the sophomore from Woodbury, New Jersey, already has 3 touchdown receptions. Here's Terrell Willis, tackled at the 45-yard line wrapped up by Ted McDuffie, number 38.
Tackled by Ted McDuffie.
Willis had put together some spectacular numbers. At one point, four rushes for 110 yards tonight. Gains of 47, 10, 17, and 36 yards. That gain of three is going to hurt the average, Bob.
He'll make it up, believe me. There'll be big plays along the way to change that average.
Lucas, rolling right, stumbles forward, gets down about a yard shy of the first down. Ted McDuffie, who's in the ball game for the Owls, makes the play, but a flag in the backfield.
The flag could go against Rutgers, probably on the block. There it is. As Lucas takes off, that was run all the way. He drove his wide receiver Walker deep to take the contain man off, and then he just turned it upfield. But somebody was illegally using hands. Here it is.
Offense, illegal block in the back above the waist, 10-yard penalty, repeat, second down.
Ray Lucas in 1993, 11 rushes, averaging 5.4 yards a carry and scoring two touchdowns. And of course, making those numbers even more impressive, Bob, is the fact that the quarterback has dropped for a loss and that negative yardage added into the rushing totals. Lucas, complete to Battaglia, who made a nice play as the ball was thrown inside. He spun around to make the reception and pick up about seven.
And that's what Ray Lucas has to learn. Here he is, he's got second down and about 16 yards to go, that you got time to make it up. You don't have to get it all in one pass. That time he went to his intermediate receiver, Battaglia, the tight end on the sideline. He picked up enough. Now he's looking at third and seven instead of maybe looking at second and 16, trying to go deep.
They'll work with Brantley and Walker to the left. Double tight end set. Lucas scrambling right. First down, Rutgers. Tackled by Marcus Counts. Bob, was that by design as he cut back to the right?
No way. He had three receivers to the left side, the tight end and two wide receivers. As you look at this, and we'll hold it for a minute, you'll see to this side, we have three receivers. So he's coming to sprint on this side, looking for one of them to get the first down. When he realizes they're covered, he gets a good block by Willis to give him a chance. He just reverses his field. His natural instinct, because he can run, is to take off. And that time he knew where the sticks were, and he got the first down.
T. Lang Lloyd, number 96, was coming, and Presley got a piece of him. But first down, Rutgers. Lucas winds up incomplete. He was looking for Chris Brantley, and Ray Lucas knows that that wasn't his best effort there as he tries to encourage the offense. Bill Cosby on the sidelines.
He's trying to encourage the defense. He's counting them, making sure there's 11 out there right now. But he is active on the sideline, and he is involved in this program, and it's great. And he's got time for everybody.
The two most famous Temple faces, the Owl and the Cause. Second and 10 for Rutgers. Bruce Presley. Presley bounces outside. Tackled by Mike Williams, but not before Presley gains 8 yards.
Rutgers beautifully utilizing their tailbacks, alternating Presley and Terrell Willis. And there's the rushing yardage. There's the big difference tonight. Getting a rushing game going, getting the ball in the hands of their tailbacks. Meanwhile, defensively, Rutgers playing it very tough, gaining momentum and confidence with each series on defense.
Bruce Presley, the sophomore from Highland Park, who was the Big East Rookie of the Year last season. Lucas to Brantley. First down, Rutgers to the Temple. 30-yard line.
Can't do it any better, Pat, than that. That's pure sprint on the corner. Temple's defense is aligned defensively to where they can block that end and give the quarterback, Lucas, a chance to get there. As he gets there, he delivers the ball beautifully. Brantley makes the catch for first down.
Well, Doug Graber said during the week that he's very happy to have Lance Avina back and available. Avina missed the Penn State game. He's their possession receiver for the Scarlet Knights. Provides a nice dimension. Here up the middle is Presley. And Presley gets 5, maybe 6 yards before Scott Holland makes the tackle.
Where's Avina? Avina runs the routes. He's the backside receiver, as you mentioned. What that means is he's the guy they throw those little curls, those comeback patterns to, the hitches, the possession passes, which get you the first down when you need him. He's experienced. He knows how to get open, and it's nice to see him back as a senior with a chance to play.
Lance Avina from Berwick, Pennsylvania. Second and 5. Pitch to Presley. And Avina makes a big block down in the left corner. Presley gets down to the Temple 9-yard line. Jeff Coles made the stop. First and goal, Rutgers.
The way that Temple is playing defensively, you've got a chance. This man right here is hookable. He's blockable either by the end or the back coming up. And because of that, you have a chance on Singleton 94 to get on the corner. He takes an inside route. The tight end stays with him, makes the block. That was Pernetti, and gives the back 44 Presley a chance to get on the corner running, and you're going to make yardage with that guy on the corner.
Lucas, incomplete. He had Brantley and Avina in the vicinity. Ray Lucas has to be careful. Rutgers wants to come away with at least 3 and maybe a touchdown. It was Lucas on the first possession against Penn State that threw the interception when he got a little flustered.
Exactly right. And that time he came out on a sprint. But remember, the field has shrunk now. He's inside the 10-yard line. The receivers are being covered in a tighter fashion, so he's got to wait a little longer to give him a chance to develop. That time he hurried the pass.
We saw Doug Graber docking it over with Earl Rison. Triple receivers to the right for Lucas. Hand off to Willis. To the 5. Terrell Willis. Touchdown, Rutgers.
You're looking at big league stuff there, number 31. That is just terrific moves. Great call from the sideline, Coach Graber. 3 receivers to the wide side of the field. Long yardage situation, second and long. They run up inside, get a great block, and Willis breaks a couple of tackles and goes in for the score.
Terrell Willis, 7 carries for 124 yards. John Benestad, the senior from Boca Raton, Florida. Drives it right between the uprights. And Rutgers leads 28-0.
Good drive, good execution, good leadership by that guy there, number 1. Watch this. They have 3 receivers out here. They're going to run the ball back inside. It's a good block by the right guard. I think it's Spitzer. Scott Vaughn again. Number 77, the right tackle. Blocks down, gives him a chance to get in the crease, and the rest is history. Vaughn doing a great job up front, the senior out of Phillipsburg. There's the block. You see him come down. There it is. Seals it off and gives him a chance to make the cut. 26 comes up, tries to get his head in front of him. But if you don't put your arms around this guy, you're never going to bring him down.
Coming into your living room, Terrell Willis. And the Scarlet Knights lead Temple 28-0 with 8:23 left here in the second quarter. We'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium in a moment.
Join us for the Chieftains in concert with special guests Roger Daltrey and Nancy Griffith, Sunday at 4:30. Feel the power of gospel, Sunday at 5:30.
I like NJN because NJN is New Jersey sports channel.
Because it's our hometown network.
And it covers everything about New Jersey.
That's the New Jersey channel.
NJN, New Jersey's own public television.
You're watching NJN, the New Jersey channel. WNJS, Camden.
and welcome back to Giant Stadium. Pat Scanlon, Bob Cassiola, and Mike Mayock. Scarlet Knights up 28-0 is John Benestad with a whirly bird kickoff to Jeff Frederick. Frederick brought down as he crosses the 20-yard line. Tackle made by Reggie Funderburk. Let's go down to the sidelines to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Well, you can see Bill Cosby chasing people down and telling them what a great job they did on that kickoff. That's my interview. Hey, Bill. You left me. You left me.
Hey, I had to leave. I had the coach out here. We're losing, and then we got a player who wants to go out and cause a penalty and give them 15 more yards. Like they could really use a penalty.
So what'd you tell him?
I told him, you want a flag? He said, no, coach. So I know he doesn't know anything about football. Call me a coach.
Okay, we'll be right back down
here. Where are you going? It's lonely down here.
Malik Jackson makes the interception. Second of the year for Jackson. He had one against Penn State, and he intercepts Phil Lang. Great instincts from the strong safety.
Whenever you put the ball in the middle, you always look for the possibility of coming up with the interception. Look at the drop by Jackson, and he just plays the ball right there. It's overthrown, intended for number 19, Baxter, and he just overthrows the ball. As you watch the reaction of the quarterback line, it's been a long night for that youngster, and he's got a lot of time left in this ball game.
Third turnover for the Temple Owls. Now Brian Forte back at quarterback for the Scarlet Knights. Forte for Presley. Great catch by Presley as he spun behind to get the ball very close to a first down. Mike Mayock, go ahead.
Okay, here we are again with Mr. Cosby. Tell me a little bit about your involvement in this football program. Okay, don't tell me anymore. What do you want to talk about here? Tell me a little bit about your involvement with Ron Dickerson. Thank you very much. What can we talk about down here? You're killing me, Mr. Cosby.
I want the game stopped.
Right now?
Yeah, we can all go home now. This is not fair.
I think I'm ready to go home. Back upstairs, guys.
Here's Forte. Complete to West Bridges. Down to the 20-yard line. Tackled by Keno Cox. We'll hear from Bill Cosby a little later on. Well, Mike Mayock, a new role as straight man, Bob Cassiola.
Well, it's not only a straight man, it's a great learning experience for Mike Mayock. But that's a tough situation to be under. Forte that time came out with a little bootleg action and hit West Bridges, the senior out of Ewing High School in Trenton, in the flat. Big play for Bridges and nice execution for a first down.
The handoff to Presley. Presley just straight ahead running, picking his way across the 15 to the 14. Cox, number 5, the free safety, makes another tackle along with Evans Charles.
Good job up front, too. For Rutgers tonight, the offensive line getting a lot of big plays in. Ken Damon, Pat Kochus, and Mike Craig at the other guard position. Kareem Williams, we told you about, starting at center. Spitzer and Scott Vaughn doing a big job up front, giving these backs a chance to run and also giving protection to the quarterback when he throws.
Here's the pitch to Presley. Presley across the 10-yard line. Close to a first down. And the Scarlet Knights with the ball inside the 10. Bruce Presley just straight ahead running. He's a bruiser. 5'10", 215 pounds.
I think maybe they're trying to spell him a little bit because he's been nicked early in the season, but he's hanging in there tough and making those runs, and that's his play. That little toss where you can stay outside and cut it back in.
On first and goal for the 9, Willis. Temple rising to the occasion. Tackle made by Corey Green, number 53. He stayed home. Made the stop and a little slow getting up, but he's okay. Got a timeout on the field now. Mike Spitzer, the senior from Sukasuna, shaking up on the play.
Spitzer, of course, came over from the defense to give some depth to this offensive line. And it's been a long process for him, but he's improving each week, and he's having a good night tonight. We just hope this senior is not too serious with this injury.
Don Kessler.
Rutgers fans can follow all the exciting action.
Training staff on to attend this pitcher. Help to his feet. Well, it's a special night for a number of former Scarlet Knight heroes. The 1993 Rutgers Hall of Fame inductees, including Ron Cherry, former quarterback Ed McMichael.
Sam Pickett and John Powers, a lot of great names here, and they're all going to have that moment at halftime tonight. And perhaps we'll have a chance a little later on to talk to some of these people.
Ron Cherry, who was a defensive back at Kansas City when Doug Graber was coaching the secondary there. Meanwhile, Rutgers on second and goal from the 7-yard line. Forte to Bradley. Touchdown, Rutgers. Sixth touchdown of the year for Chris Brantley.
What you do when you get down in here, you get tight coverage. That time, the cornerback was Marcus Counts, number 45. Brantley just ran a little slant pattern inside, and Forte just set up and waited for him to come over and put the ball open and put the ball right where it should be. Big score.
What a difference a Saturday night makes 7 days after the Penn State debacle. Doug Graber enjoying a 35-0 lead as Benestad packs on the extra point.
And as we look at this, we'll see this. Forte is going to just drop, step back, and Brantley coming from the right side is just going to come open on a slant pattern inside of the defender, number 45, Counts. And Forte just looks him up all the way. Good pass protection up front. Gives him plenty of time and good delivery. A lot on that football, and he's wide open for the score. Brantley does a lot for you. Returns, kickoffs. Does this now from ground level. You should see it even better as Forte takes his drop back here, and you'll see number 12 coming right into the picture there. Perfectly delivered ball. He's got three steps on the defender.
Chris Brantley, the senior from nearby Teaneck, New Jersey. Six touchdown receptions. The Rutgers record holder for career TDs. And Brian Forte, another touchdown pass for the senior from East Brunswick. Tell you what, Bill Cosby just keeps on coaching there, talking to Evans Charles, a walk-on from Washington, D.C. With Cosby on the staff, it's a high-priced coaching staff, Bob.
Well, he's dedicated to this program, and I give him a lot of credit for that. I admire him for that. He's been that way for a long time.
Frederick on the five. Mark Washington with a special keen stop. And don't forget, in a couple of weeks, we'll have more Rutgers football here on NJN. We'll be at Mikey Stadium in West Point. Rutgers and Army.
That'll be a good one because Army, of course, runs the wishbone. You hate like heck to have to prepare for it in 1 week. They do a good job against you. They always play Rutgers tough, and that's a great atmosphere to play in. So that'll be a very exciting football game for all of us to be up there at West Point.
Here's Lang. Hands off to the fullback, Sidney Morris. And Morris gets out to the 27-yard line. Jameel Jackson makes the stop, and Sidney Morris, a junior, strong blocker, and he was their leading returning rusher coming into this fall.
Rich Rachel, defensive coordinator, Rutgers, now substituting people. We've got Shane Spells in at one linebacker position. Rashad Swinger is at the nose, so it gives him a chance to get some new faces in there. Roger Jeffries at defensive end gives these guys a chance to get game experience right now.
Dan Latour in at tailback. Lang looking downfield. Incomplete. Intended for Tim Israel, and Michael Roberts made a nice play at cornerback.
Remember, we talked about the quarterback lying sort of winding up to throw the ball. When he does that, it gives the defensive back, in that case, Roberts, a chance to make a read or make a move on the football. And he did that and came up and made the play. Beautifully done. Now, we talked about Roberts. We talked about Mike Fullman, two redshirt freshmen. They're learning under the gun. It's a tough situation for them, but they can only get better. And in recent weeks, we've seen Michael Roberts. He's come in with 15 solo tackles and one interception coming in this game. So he's learning, and he's coming along fast.
Baxter in motion. Lyon rolling to his left. Now has to pull it down and pays the price. Mike Fullman, the other redshirt freshman.
Rutgers again with six defensive backs in the game, so it's tough for that quarterback Lang to find anybody that's open. And he has to tuck it and try and get some yardage. Close to a first down.
Good look at Shane Spells, the junior from New Brunswick. Playing behind Swartz at outside linebacker. Fourth and one. And so John Shea will have to punt. Chris Brantley back to Rutgers' 25-yard line. And Shea averaging over 43 yards a punt. Good punt will send Brantley to the 23-yard line. Brantley trying to get away from Fredericks, turns it up, and is driven out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Mike Williams made the play, a 44-yard punt for John Shea, who's having a much better evening than he did a week ago against Boston College.
But you can see some of the problems that Ron Dickerson's up against in his kicking game, because most of the punt returns and kickoff returns, Rutgers has been able to get outside, and that's something you never let him do.
Ray Lucas returns at quarterback.
A 30% cut, that's the Whitman plan for taxes. But in the 4th District Senate race, both candidates take issue with her proposal.
I think that I owe it to my constituents to make sure that I study the budget that's presented next year before I can guarantee any tax cuts.
You can't run around and promise tax cuts when we have no plan. And that's basically what is happening.
Join Larry Stupnagel as Senator John Mathewson and his opponent Ben Lynch go on the record Friday at 8, Sunday at 12:30.
Business news is everyone's business, and it's our business to report it. I'm Paul Kangas of the Nightly Business Report. If it's happening in Kuwait, Europe, or Japan, count on NBR to be on the scene.
And I'm Kathy Seifert in New York, where NBR provides on-the-scene coverage of the financial markets. Make it your business to watch.
Weeknights at 7 here on NJN, the New Jersey Channel.
Back at Giant Stadium, Rutgers leading 35-0. Ray Lucas in at quarterback. Hands off to Terrell Willis. And he streaks into Temple territory to the 33-yard line. Robert McWilliams made the tackle in the blink of an eye. Willis is gone.
He's saying, is this what varsity football on the college level is all about, huh? Every time they give me the football, I ramble.
33 yards that time.
Amazing. But a good job up front, the right side of that offensive line and the blocking, opening up holes and giving him anything. If you just give him an inch, he's going to make yardage, but there's some gaping holes up front.
Tell you what, Bobby, with Willis out there on the field, the chain gang is getting a workout. They're going to be spent by the second half. Bridges and Willis, the running backs for Rutgers. Here's Willis. Lowered his shoulder, got across the 30, down to the 28-yard line. Lance Johnstone, the sophomore for Temple, making the tackle. Oh, you have a chance. Let's get out to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Hey, Bill, I got a technical football question for you. On that long play, what happened? There it is, guys. Words of wisdom from the cause.
Oh. I don't know if Mayock was organized that or Cosby set him up for that. I think Cosby probably told him that.
Rutgers having its way with Temple. Bill Cosby having his way with Mike Mayock. Now here's Lucas. The pass is complete. Pete Lamicella, the wide receiver, makes the play for Rutgers. Mike, what's the update on Mike Spitzer?
Patrick, what we have is a mild knee sprain. Apparently, it's not very serious, but with the score 35-0, excuse me, they're going to keep him out of the game. Sophomore Pat Gorman, number 51, will get some work tonight.
Okay, Mike, Gorman, number 51, a sophomore from Mullica Hills. Here's Terrell Willis. Fighting his way forward. And the referee, and that scrum. Tough to get out of the way, Bob. And a
very late flag here as we're looking at this. This is just this little counter action or draw action. Fullback leads him up in the middle. And he just makes yardage, takes the ball to the 15-yard line.
But a holding call will back it up.
Late call coming in and the holding. We're trying to get it because they're making so many changes. That was the back judge, Tom Tornizek, who came in and threw the flag.
He's none the worse for wear, holding Rutgers.
Line of scrimmage, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So Rutgers will back up, first and 20.
Again, Rutgers working the offensive line. Ken Damon at left tackle. Pat Kochus at left guard. Watch the penalty right here, and you can see, well, that's just a little flare-up going up between Walker and the defender.
First and 20 from the 32. Willis spins away. Still on his feet, down to the 11-yard line. Robert McWilliams just got him off balance, and it has become a Terrell Willis highlight show.
That's exactly right. You just keep watching this guy make his cuts, the tremendous balance he has, the body lean, and he runs. Watch this. He's running a toss to the left side. He cuts it back inside. What they try to do is run that up inside or run it wide, but he makes a complete turn and comes back against the grain to the right side of the field. And look at the balance. Look at the effort. And, of course, at the end, he's very upset that he didn't get a touchdown. But what a run.
Now Bruce Presley is in. Funderburk and Walker split to the left. Lucas from the shotgun. Lobbing it into the end zone. He was looking in the vicinity of Eddie Walker. And coverage on the play by Evans Charles.
Again, we're deep in their territory. Sure, you're up 35-0, but the principles are these. Don't throw the ball away or throw it up for grabs, rather, and get an interception. Come up with some points. Good call or good reaction by Ray Lucas in that sequence.
You wouldn't know that Rutgers had a 35-0 lead from the expression on Doug Graber's face. He's trying to send a message. Hand off to Presley. Bruce Presley in for his second touchdown of the evening.
Great job of running by Bruce Presley. Great job of blocking on the right side. Scott Vaughn. Gorman in for Spitzer at right guard, and of course Kareem Williams at center. Big hole, and when you get that guy motoring as he does, he's going to get in the end zone, and he did. Big score for Rutgers.
11 yards for the touchdown. Bruce Presley, his second of the night, second of the season. John Benestad, who has been very busy, has the extra point blocked. It's recovered by Kyle Glasper. And Glasper tackled. He could run it in for a point.
Forte is the guy that tackled him. Excellent job that time by Forte chasing him down. A great effort, kept his positioning, and made the play.
Not the first big play Brian Forte's made on a special team, Bob.
And those guys love it. Tomorrow when they show that film, they'll run it back and forth to show that tackle by number 7, and even Doug Graber gets a laugh on that one. Not happy about having that kick blocked, though.
Corey Green got a hand on it and blocked it. And now it's Ben tonight. The Knights and the Owls here at Giant Stadium. Of course, Forte, remember, he fielded a bad snap on the point after try against Duke and ran it in for a two-point conversion, and Rutgers wound up winning that game by a point, 39-38. Forte bringing the Knights back that night from a 16-point deficit. with 12 minutes left in the game. Right now, 41-0 Rutgers. I get the feeling there'll be an awful lot of substitutions coming up in the second half as Rutgers attempts to bring along some backup players.
And our Bill Friel from Norristown, PA, will have to get his fingers down that lineup and make sure he's got all those numbers when they start coming in.
Jeff Frederick and Damon Atwater back to receive for Temple. Benestad drives Frederick into the end zone, and he'll come out once again. Frederick flagged down. Brought down across the 31-yard line by Eddie Walker. But a flag on the play. Holding Temple.
Just when they got themselves some field position, they come up with a penalty that kills them. And Ron Dickerson knows it.
Holding on to return against the receiving team. First down.
So the Owls will back up to their own 14 as we take a look at how Bruce Presley capped a 63-yard, six-play drive.
Watch the right side here as they hand the ball back to him. He makes the cut. He gets a great block by number 77, Scott Vaughn, on the big defensive tackle, Scott Holland. And that's all he needed to get into the end zone. And a big score, and Rutgers is up 41-0 with 1:17 left here in the first half.
Lang continuing at quarterback. Eye formation. Baby is Danny Davis met in the backfield by Rashad Swinger. And Swinger swung him down to the ground.
Very quick, very intense, 6'3", 286 from Manalapan. Watch the nose tackle, beat the block here, and get into the backfield. And the back never has a chance to make the cut right there. As he gets in, number 99, Rashad Swinger makes the hit. And he's maybe what they're looking for in that defensive line. He's only a redshirt freshman, but he's a real fine prospect.
Second team, All-State. Second and 13. This time it's Keith Bryant combining with Brian Sheridan. So Temple trying to keep it on the ground and get into the locker room at the half.
Keith Bryant, good to see Keith Bryant back playing this week. He got nicked up a little bit last week against Penn State. The big junior out of Largo, Florida, brings a lot of experience to this defense.
Suffered a strained knee against Duke. And that's the end of the first half of play. It's been all Rutgers as the Scarlet Knights lead the Temple Owls 41-0 here at Giant Stadium. Let's go down to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Hey, Coach, here we are. It's 41-0 at halftime. A little different than last week, but you started out a little bit sloppy and then picked it up.
I thought we started off real sloppy. On the offensive side of the ball, I think that defensively we've played with a lot of intensity the first half, and I'm pleased with that. But we've really been on again, off again.
What prompted the decision to start Brian Forte tonight?
Well, that decision was made during the week, and we just simply felt he deserved an opportunity to play. He's done everything we've asked. He's practicing well, playing well.
Last question. In a game like this, what do you do in the second half to keep the intensity and the crisp play and go into BC next week on an up note?
Well, that's always a concern, we're going to get a lot of kids some playing time in the second half, and I'm not interested in embarrassing anybody. That's not, so... Feel badly for Temple right now, and away we go.
Okay, Coach, thanks very much. Hey, Patrick, I was with a little bit more talkative Doug Graver than Bill Cosby. Back upstairs.
Okay, Mike. The Scarlet Knights leading Temple 41-0. We're at halftime.
I'm Richard Lindley. On ITN World News, I'll be bringing you the top stories from ITN's reporting team around the globe.
Michael Brunson, ITN, Westminster.
In the North Sea.
In the Amazon.
In the Black Sea.
In South Africa.
Barcelona.
Moscow.
Robert Moore, ITN, Baghdad.
Washington.
Monday to Friday, ITN World News.
Tune in weeknights at 11:30 exclusively on NJN.
Clean drinking water. We can't live without it. That's why environmentalists are fighting to protect Sterling Forest, New York from development. Crystal clear streams flowing out of the forest cross the state line into northern New Jersey's water supply, but this pristine supply is in jeopardy. Environmentalists warn that fragmenting the forest will destroy the watershed forever. Their overriding concern, preserving pure water.
Thursday at 8:30.
We're at halftime. Rutgers in its Big East opener, leading the Temple Owls 41-0. Let's take a look at some first half stats, Bob, and Scarlet Knights establishing the running game.
No question about that. The rushing yards are 268. They want to get the ball to the tailbacks. They've done it tonight by getting the ball in the hands of Bruce Presley and Terrell Willis has run wild, and they've racked up the yardage, running the football, consequently helping their offense by opening up the passing lanes. The only negative you could look at Rutgers are the penalties, 5 for 38 yards, which came early and hurt them a little bit getting started in the first quarter.
A key highlight from the first half revolved around the defense. Malik Jackson and, of course, the linebacker, Rusty Swartz.
Right here is Rusty Swartz, 59. Then you're going to see Jackson. Here's the big play as the quarterback, Lang, drops back. He's looking for a receiver. Rutgers is leading 7-0 at this junction. Now he's trying to scramble. As he scrambles, watch 59 come from the backside. He comes over the top, gets the arm, slaps the ball away. 43, Malik Jackson picks it up on the run, breaks the tackle of 71, the defensive tackle, as he comes to get him, gets into the end zone. It's 14-0. This got the momentum going, turned the game around, and the offense got started, and you started to see the tailbacks come into the play, particularly when you look at Terrell Willis back here at the tailback spot. He was doing this entirely the first half. Little draw action. He starts off the right side following number 32, West Bridges. And look at the cutback right here. And he breaks it off and gets this ball all the way down to the 2-yard line for Rutgers to go in and get another score. Terrell Willis in the first half has 182 yards. And I'll tell you, he is exciting.
First, the last Rutgers player to rush for 200 yards in a game was Kurt Edwards versus William and Mary back in 1975. He rushed for 205 yards. Doug Graber would like to see Willis continue to rush successfully along with that tailback spot, Bruce Presley. As we get ready for our second half kickoff, John Benestad starts us off. And Damon Atwater from the goal line. Atwater tackled just inside the 20-yard line. Curtis Tribbett makes the play for Rutgers. Well, Rutgers did establish the ground game, to say the least, in the first half, Bob.
That's a pretty good balance, particularly if you can move the ball on the ground, mixes up your plays, gives your quarterback a real chance to get going. And we're going to see, talking about quarterbacks, a change for Temple at quarterback.
Ryan Forte, 7 of 11 for Rutgers. Phil Lang, 5 of 13 for 48 yards. Forte with a couple of scores, but now at quarterback, number 14, Henry Burris, a freshman from Spiro, Oklahoma. And he'll begin by handing off to Danny Davis, and Davis is dropped for a loss by Keith Bryant, number 91.
Henry Burris is out of Spiro, Oklahoma. He has potential, a lot of potential, but it's down the road. But in this situation, Ron Dickerson has no choice but to get him in the ball game and see if he can generate some offense for him and give him some experience.
6'2", 190 pounds. He's thrown for one touchdown. That a late pass in the Boston College game to Ramondo Davidson. From the I formation, Davis at tailback. Danny Latour at fullback. And a whistle. Referee Tom Famert. That's going to go against Rutgers.
Defense. Second down.
It's going to go against the nose tackle that time, who moved just before the snap and made contact.
Number 99, Rashad Swinger, in at nose tackle now.
We mentioned he's very quick. He's very quick, but he's young, inexperienced again. He's got to go on movement, not on sound.
Well, the 5-yard penalty against Rutgers makes it 2nd and 10 for Temple. Here's the pitch to Davis. And Davis gets out to the 29-yard line. Jay Bellamy made the tackle. That's the first time we've called Bellamy's name tonight.
Well, that tells you that the front people are making the tackles before they get to the free safety. That's an important call. You don't want the free safety being called a lot because you know they're getting into the secondary with their runs. Davis, by the way, is another freshman out of Ocean City, New Jersey, and he's the speed guy in this offense. He rushed for 54 yards before coming into this game.
On the I formation, here's the pitch to Davis. And I don't believe he got there. They went for it on third and one. Pitching deep to Davis, and Malik Jackson, the senior strong safety, made the tackle. There's Danny Davis. 31 rushes.
How are you holding up, bro?
One touchdown. Ron Dickerson calls him my wiggler. He can make people miss. Now on is John Shea. Averaging just under 44 yards a punt tonight. Chris Brantley back to receive for Rutgers. And Brantley lets it bounce, and that will go out of bounds at the Rutgers 31-yard line. A 40-yard punt. We'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium after this.
Hi, I'm Mary Cummings. Noted defense attorney William Kunstler is our guest next time on New Jersey Tonight. He's representing Sheikh Omar Abdelrahman. He's charged with leading 14 of his followers in a war of urban terrorism against the United States, a war which allegedly includes the bombing of the World Trade Center and the murder of Rabbi Meir Kahane. Sheikh and his followers say they are innocent. We talk about it on the next New Jersey Tonight with William Kunstler, only on NJN, the New Jersey Channel.
As you may know, new federal regulations have affected television cable operators this year. NJN is working with dozens of cable systems to bring the NJN signal to all of New Jersey, parts of New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. With their help, millions more people can now see NJN in New York and Pennsylvania. Along with these changes, the channel your local cable operator uses to bring NJN to you may change. We'll still be there for you. Ask your cable company if you can't find NJN, the New Jersey channel.
You're watching NJN, the New Jersey Channel. WNJS, Camden.
Welcome back to Giant Stadium. Let's go down on the sidelines to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Patrick, joining me tonight is a very special guest. It's Hall of Fame inductee, Deron Cherry. And Deron, welcome back to the state of New Jersey.
I tell you, it's great to be back, and the game's been wonderful so far. I've enjoyed it, but I really enjoyed coming back and seeing some of my old teammates. It's been a great weekend.
Tell me the story, if you would, about, I know you were a punter and a safety here at college. And from what I hear, you really got your shot with the Chiefs as a punter.
Yeah, I got my shot with the Chiefs as a punter, and then they wanted to change my style and everything. So they kind of told me that I wasn't going to make the team, so I had to make a quick switch and go over to playing safety. And thank God for Marv Levy. He gave me an opportunity, and the rest has been history.
Since you've played there for how many years down in Kansas City?
Played for 11 years in Kansas City. And
and how many Pro Bowls?
Six Pro Bowls and two more as an alternate.
Not bad for a guy that they only thought could punt, right?
Exactly. I tell you, it's a storybook career for me, and maybe one of these days I'll sit down and write it all down in pencil. And but it's been incredible. It's been great, and thanks to Rutgers University, number one, for giving me an opportunity not only to play athletics but to get a great education.
Well, speaking of Rutgers University, tell me a little bit about Coach Graber as a pro coach.
Well, as you know, I'm very fond of Coach Graber, and he's a very good personal friend of mine, and I think he's done a tremendous job here at Rutgers. And when you see some of the talent that he's been able to bring to Rutgers football, you understand that Rutgers is heading definitely in the right direction.
Okay. Deron, would you like to say something, Deron? He's just like Bill Cosby. He won't talk to me. Back upstairs, guys.
Well, Brian Forte hooked up with Marco Battaglia to get out to the 45-yard line. And Doug Graber did coach Deron Cherry in that Kansas City Chief backfield. Forte getting to start at quarterback here in the second half, rolling out, hitting Brantley into Temple territory, breaks a tackle, and pulled out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Chris Brantley making people miss, and Brian Forte, again, very accurate, a 15-yard gain.
We talk about Forte as a dropback passer. That time they sprinted him, and he delivered the ball on the corner, which shows he does have that ability to do all that. He prefers to stay in the pocket. But that time, Brantley made the catch, and he gave away about 30 pounds and still made extra yardage as that DB tried to come up and muscle him out of bounds. But Brantley is quite a competitor.
This time it's Walker in motion. Funderburk split to the right. Hand off to Willis. There goes Terrell Willis down to the 31-yard line. Terrell Willis, who had 182 yards in the first half. Here's John Swift making the tackle.
He runs this little draw action and follow the fullback 32 going up in their bridges, and then he breaks it wherever he sees the opening, and then he gets the seam and he gets upfield. That's good running on the part of Willis, and he picks up. You look around, it doesn't look like much. He picked up 8 yards.
Forte called timeout. Second and two for Rutgers.
A little mix up here as far as the probably what the formation or the play they want to call.
Or personnel.
Right, exactly. Perhaps the wrong personnel in for that particular play.
Oh, don't forget, next week, our game of the week here on NJN will be in the New Jersey Athletic Conference. The Kane Cougars and the Montclair State Redhawks. Under the lights from Upper Montclair. It's homecoming at Montclair State. Should be a good game. There's the Redhawks, who've earlier beaten Ithaca College 29-0. Always one of the great programs in Division III. So we look forward to that coverage next Sunday morning. Michigan today in Big Ten play over Iowa, 24-7. Whew, Arkansas by.
Big upset. Arkansas winning inside the hedges. Of course, there's a tough one. Colgate came back, and Columbia scores 24 points and can't get a victory. That's tough.
We'll see Columbia against Princeton later in our Ivy League coverage later on this season. Now second and two, Forte. Pitch to Presley. And Presley gets behind Bridges. John Swift made the tackle, and a flag flew in the direction of the tackle. Jeff Coles, strong safety, also staying home.
They're going to call this against Wes Bridges, the fullback who's leading on the corner that he blocked below the knees. Bridges, of course, getting a chance to get into this game and get some activity as a senior.
Illegal block below the waist. Towards the ball against the offense, 15-yard penalty.
Wes Bridges, the senior from Trenton out of Ewing High School. 6'1", 225, a senior. And then his father's involved in the Ewing Township government. Second and 14. Forte into the flat to the tight end Battaglia. And Marco Battaglia lowers the shoulder and gets down to the 25-yard line. He took on Robert McWilliams and Jeff Coles.
The sophomore out of St. Francis Prep over in New York City played for the great football coach Vinny O'Connor. That's Marco Battaglia. And here's Forte on the drop back, hitting the tight end in the flat. He comes down, runs a sideline cut, just comes across rather, runs that cut, makes, concentrates as that hand goes flashing in front of him to make the catch. And several impressive receptions tonight for Battaglia.
Well, he has come back from a poor performance against Penn State with a vengeance. Presley down to the 20-yard line. T. Lang Lloyd, number 96, a freshman from Willingboro, tripped him up. At one point against Boston College last week, T. Lang Lloyd was one of 11 redshirt freshmen on the field at once. So you get an idea of the young talent on this Temple team. They'll come along. They've got a lot of experience to gain, however.
No,
Second down, 5 yards to go. Pitch again to Presley. Presley wrapped up from behind by James Spears, number 88. Former Temple Owl basketball player. And Presley now hits the century mark, 16 carries for 100 yards.
They're coming right at us with the toss sweep, number 74. That's Rick Ortiz pulling from the left guard position to lead it on the corner. As Presley lowers, good job by 88 Spears coming down the line to make the hit before he could get the first down.
James Spears, who has a knack for getting to the quarterback, has two sacks to lead the Temple defense. Third and one. Three tight ends in for Rutgers as Bridges goes in motion. They pitch it out to Presley. And Presley got the first down. James Spears was coming again, but Presley was able to get forward and move the chains for the Scarlet Knights.
Good job. They come in with three tight ends, as you described it, and they get on the corner with Presley, and he gets the first down. Rutgers keeping the ball on the ground here. Ahead 41-0. Keep possession, get in for another score.
And keeping that clock moving. 8:15 left. Knights content to keep it on the ground, grind it out. Willis and Bridges at running back. Forte to Henry. Mario Henry down to the eight. Tackled by Lance Johnstone and Mike Williams.
Little stop pattern to the wide receiver, Henry. He's just going to come down and turn back to the football. He gets about 5-6 yards. First down call. Good delivery. Excellent delivery. Henry's open and just turns up in upfield to get another extra yard.
Rutgers can pick up a first down inside the 10 here. Second and four on the 8-yard line. Forte has to call another timeout.
I mean, I'm sure they're not happy about that, even though they're ahead 41-0, to think that he's called a second timeout. There's 7:26 remaining in the third quarter. It can't hurt him here because they're ahead, but it's still not the way you want to play the game. And it's a matter, again, of getting him in the right formation.
Well, as Doug Graber talks it over with senior quarterback Brian Forte, Major League Baseball, the Braves beating the Rockies 10-1. So Atlanta trying to get ahead of the Giants, but the Giants beat the Dodgers 5-3. Oral Hershiser out of Cherry Hill going for the Dodgers, so they remain deadlocked with one game left. Game left, they'll play tomorrow, and if they need a playoff, it'll be Monday. Meanwhile, the moon over the Meadowlands. Great night for football, and great night to be a Rutgers Scarlet Knight. I'm hard to believe the Giants and the Braves, 103 wins apiece. What a great pennant race it's turned into in the National League West. Here's Terrell Willis. And Temple pursuing well.
Well, the time they were ready for him. Running to the wide side of the field. Great pursuit on the part of Temple, and never gave Terrell Willis a chance to make the cutback. One of the few times tonight he hasn't had that opportunity. And Evans Charles came up to make the hit from the strong safety position. And now it's a third down and about three. And again, as you noted, they can make a first down without scoring a touchdown here.
Well, in the contest, Temple had 4 first downs to 9 for Rutgers. Right now, Rutgers has 23 first downs. Looking for number 24 here. Forte on the move to Brantley. Touchdown Rutgers, Chris Brantley. And Brian Forte hooking up for a second time tonight.
That's two wide receivers. They bring the widest receiver, Avina, down inside like a pick play, and they slide the inside receiver into the flat, and he's wide open. Tough to defend against because you got tight coverage down here, man coverage. We'll get a chance to look at it a little bit later.
Very similar pattern. Might have been the same play, Bob, that was called back against Penn State as Ray Lucas hooked up with Brantley. Later, his touchdown was taken off the board due to an illegal formation. Benistan. Out of the hold of Frank Edgerly. It's good. And with 6:39 left in the third quarter, Rutgers 48, Temple nothing. Brian Forte, 7 yards to Chris Brantley. They covered 69 yards in 11 plays.
Watch the play here. What you're going to see on the right corner is you're going to see Avina come down, number 19, and just slide into that void area, and 12, Brantley, get out in the flat as Forte sprints onto the right side and delivers the football on the run. Here it starts now as he comes out, and what you're going to see is you see 19 come down, and right there, just enough so that defender could not get over in front of Brantley to make any play on the football. Well-timed. Beautifully executed. Touchdown, Rutgers.
Brantley's seventh touchdown reception of the season, and Brian Forte now with another touchdown to his credit. Let's go down to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Hey, Pat, very quietly, Chris Brantley has become the career touchdown reception leader. He's got 17. He started the night with 15. He's fourth in career yardage and sixth in career receptions. I say very quietly because he played in the shadow of Jimmy Garantano the last 2 years. Back upstairs, guys.
Chris Brantley, of course, breaking Bob Sims' record. He came into the game with 15 touchdown records, or touchdown receptions, and number one in the Rutgers record book.
Stan Parrish feels he's the best receiver they've had since they've been here with this, with Doug Graber's regime. Brantley has been the most consistent over those years.
Atwater with his best return of the night. Out to the 27-yard line, tackled by Sean Smith. We'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium right after this.
Feel the power of gospel Sunday at 5:30.
I hope you're enjoying this hour-long NJN News. Tell us what you think. Write NJN News, CN 777, Trenton 08625.
Welcome back to Giant Stadium. Pat Scanlon, Bob Cassiola, and Mike Mayock here. Rutgers leading 48 to nothing. Henry Burris at quarterback for Temple. Hands off to Danny Davis. Davis gets outside and is met head on by Mike Bressel. Mike Bressel, a redshirt freshman from Ventnor, New Jersey, out of Holy Spirit High School. First team All-Stater.
They like Bressel. He's 6 foot, 230 pounds, comes out of a great program at Holy Spirit that's turned out many fine football players. And he's a linebacker of the future, and he's going to have a chance to play a lot tonight with 6:12 still remaining in the third period.
First down, Temple. And off to Davis. He's met that time by another backup linebacker who we'll hear a lot of in the future, Brian Sheridan, number 54. Sheridan had a neck burner and had missed a little bit of play, but good to see him out there. He's already made a few tackles tonight.
You've got Anthony Coffin in at one outside linebacker position for Rutgers, and the other we see Catano. Alcides Catano is in the game also.
Catano has played some tight end and some linebacker. Here on second and eight now for Temple. Here's Burris, rolling, looking deep, incomplete. Ray Burris intending it for Ramondo Davidson.
He was defending on that as we look at the back of the night, number 31, Terrell Willis. And what a night he's had. Derek Ward was a defensive back on that particular play and did a good job looking for the deep cut. A redshirt freshman, what do you do?
Well, Temple now going with three wide receivers. Randy Kanzader split to the left. Burris, incomplete. Intended for Tim Israel. Tim Israel, quite a story, coming back from reconstructive knee surgery. His brother Steven played for the Pitt Panthers and was a first-round pick of the L.A. Rams in 1992.
I've seen his brother play many times. Great speed, terrific hands, punt returner, kickoff returner. Very versatile athlete.
And Israel, only a sophomore. Michael Roberts back as John Shea gets the punt off. Oh, and Michael Roberts had to go off his shoulder pads and out of bounds, a flag down at the 23-yard line. Yeah, we're used to seeing number 22 back there, but it was Marshall Roberts last year, Bob, who did a great job of returns throughout his Rutgers career.
But again, the Roberts, Fullman, learning, on-the-job training, as we call it, and they're getting better all the time. That was a mistake, but he'll get better. He's a good competitor.
A three-year high school starter at Abington out of Willow Grove, Pennsylvania. Had a chance to make an interception against Penn State. Dropped the ball, but he'll come along as we listen to Tom Fammer. This is quite a discussion we're having here.
Well, he's on television, you know that.
Tom Thamert taking his cue from Bill Cosby, a man of few words here. Holding against Rutgers.
When they kick this over? Or did the holding...
Okay, Tom, let's hear about it. Holding against Rutgers, so it's a
first down
for Temple. So the Temple offense comes back on the field.
Holding against the receiving team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
All right.
I think the question there was, they knew they had the penalty. Did they give them a first down, or they force them to kick it again? They decided it occurred before, so it's a first down.
So Temple given new life, Ron Dickerson's club. First and 10 from midfield. Davidson's put to the right. Israel to the left. Here's the handoff. Mack. Excuse me, that's Barry Williams, number 29, into the ball game for the first time. Barry Williams, another redshirt freshman for this Temple team out of Jules Massbaum High School in Philadelphia, tackled by Brian Sheridan. Barry Williams, they say, has straight-ahead speed. Interesting story in that he was injured as a high school senior. He tore his anterior cruciate ligament. Missed that senior season, but Temple took a chance on him, and he's come back to play. Here's Burris, play action across the middle. Intended for Israel, and a good play by Curtis Tribbett, who's come over from the offense to play corner for the Scarlet Knights.
He was an all-state defensive back at Williamstown, Tribbett, so he makes the play here. It's a very close call. It almost looks like he may have made the contact before the pass was there, but let's see. Play action here as 14, Henry Burris fakes to his tailback. Now he sets up looking for Israel coming across, and there he is. Big hit by Tribbett. Incomplete pass.
Sean Smith, number 4, also there now. Burris looking at 3rd and 8. Pressure. Nearly intercepted. Scarlet Knights have put on the pressure, and Alcides Catano almost had himself an interception.
That's your outside linebacker dropping a support underneath in the flat. Catano did it perfectly. Had a great opportunity.
You're playing tight end as he does on offense, too. You got to catch that ball.
That's right. Here's the setup. Burris sets up. He's looking to come back here into the flat. Watch number 80, Catano, as he drops off. I guess we're not going to see that. We're going to see Roger Jeffries burying the quarterback, Henry Burris.
Shea, who's averaging 43 yards a punt, fields a snap. Funderburg runs up to it and is brought down across the 25 to the 26-yard line. Jeff Frederick made the tackle. So Doug Graber getting a chance to look at a number of freshman punt returners. Richie Funderburg out of Hyattsville, Maryland, who had shoulder surgery in 92. And now Ray Lucas comes on with 4:03 left here in the third quarter. He'll hand off. Here's Bill Bailey. And Bailey with a burst out to the 38-yard line. Mike Williams on the stop for Temple.
Under these conditions, Bill Bailey's going to get the football. And he's been around playing every role they've ever asked of him, whether it's returning kicks, blocking, running. And with the score of 48-0, Bailey lining up either as a single back in this offense, he'll carry the football a lot.
Avina to the right, Walker to the left. He's going with two tight ends. Lucas avoids the rush, complete to Tim Cornetti. And Cornetti gets out to midfield, his first catch at 1993.
Tim Cornetti, the blocker, they usually bring him in when they want two tight ends and going to run the football, but that time as Lucas scrambled, came back, found his tight end open, and he made the catch.
Tim Cornetti, also our NJN Scholar Athlete this week, a graduate student in information systems, already attained his undergraduate degree of communications. Tim Cornetti from Wyckoff, New Jersey. Here's Bill Bailey. Bailey, first down and more. Bill Bailey, and flags fly as Bailey scampers down to the 33-yard line. Marcus Counts made the stop. It's going to be holding against Rutgers.
That's a tough call, Pat, even with the score 48-0. Why? The flag is thrown near side here, well away from the play, and thrown very late. But he's got to call it like he sees it.
Joe Wentzel from Elmer, New Jersey, shaking up on the play. Mike Mayock, what's on your mind?
Well, Pat, last week both teams had troubles with their punting team. Obviously, as we know, Temple had three punts blocked in the first quarter against BC. Rutgers had one against Penn State. I asked Coach Graber and special teams coach Ed O'Neill, how long from the snap to the impact of the ball on the foot do you consider a good snap? They said 2 seconds to 2.1. Last week, David Lippitz was timed at 2.4 both kicks. They demoted Lippitz and he quit the team. So tonight, if we see any action, it'll be Nick Sheremeta as the punter.
There's special teams coach Ed O'Neill, former NFL linebacker, played for the Detroit Lions. His son now playing down in Howell High School. Chris Stoll had a chance to make his first reception of the year. Couldn't haul it in from Lucas. Chris Stoll back, seeing his first action since the Penn State game of 1992. It's good to see the senior from Ofseekin back on the field.
And another product of Holy Spirit High School.
Second and nine, Lucas hands off. Bill Bailey drives the pile, keeps those legs pumping, and gets out to the 42-yard line. Davin Miles on the stop.
A lot of changes in that offensive line. Good experience tonight. Chris Kennedy at right tackle, the sophomore out of Downingtown High School in Pennsylvania. Pat Gorman, Mike Craig, Rick Ortiz is in there too at left guard. Left tackle. Craig, the big guy from Trenton at 6'5", 310, is lining up at left guard.
Number 63. Bailey. Beetle Bailey down to the 30. First down, Rutgers. Well, he made the Scarlet Knight team as a walk-on, was awarded a scholarship by Doug Graber, and was at one point Rutgers' leading rusher.
Good job, Ed.
5'7", 193 pounds. He just gets down behind those big linemen and finds the seam. Coaches love the Bill Baileys. When you got those kind of guys on your team, you're going to win. He's got a great attitude.
Out of West Milford, New Jersey. Now Lucas, quick hitter to Lance Avina. Avina spins. That gets the first down. Lance Avina made the reception and turned it into a first down.
We talked about Avina being the backside receiver, away from the strength of the formation, likes to run the curls, the turnbacks, the shorter control patterns. That time he caught the ball, and the senior from Berwick, Pennsylvania, got the first down.
Lance Avina, who played with West Virginia quarterback Jake Kelsner at Berwick. First and 10 Rutgers. Lucas now backs up, shotgun formation. Looking for Funderburk, he'll have to run it, and Lucas goes out of bounds in the vicinity of the 14-yard line.
Interesting call coming up in a shotgun in that situation. But they put Ray Lucas back there, and he's got the speed and the quickness, and he got on the corner, picked up 5 yards.
About to get back to the performance of Bill Bailey. In 1990, he was honorable mention All-East tailback. He rushed almost 500 yards that year on 125 carries. Of course, he's changed positions now, running out of the fullback spot. Here's a pretty good, yep, there he goes now. Doing double duty, and Bailey is close to a Rutgers first down.
That's the little toss they run. They toss the ball back to the deep back, the tailback, and he can run wide this time. It's designed to go back up inside, and Bailey, of course, cut it back in there. Picked up about 4 yards, just close enough for a measurement.
Normally operating out of a fullback spot, getting his chance now as a tailback.
Here's a score in the other game.
And they're going to bring out the chains of measure. Well, Ray Lucas, who came into the game. Four touchdowns and four interceptions. Beginning to develop a little more confidence. First down, Rutgers. Offensive coordinator Stan Parrish talking about Lucas, saying that both Forte and Lucas are going to play. We just have to develop a rhythm for both. Two different game plans. One when Lucas is in, another when Forte brings his dropback style of play into action. Here's Lucas doing what he does best. Spreading out, lowers the shoulder. Touchdown, Ray Lucas. 8 yards for the score.
You called it what he does best, and that's what he does best. Get him on the corner with the football, either running or throwing. And that time he got on the corner, got good blocks downfield, and got into the end zone, and that touchdown was important for him. Important for him personally to get in there and a good drive, leading this drive downfield to get the score.
His third rushing touchdown of the season.
Experience, that's what you need. Under game conditions.
Out of the hole of Frank Edgerly. Eddie Dubois. The extra point is good. And the route continues. 55 for nothing.
Here's the run. Lucas just running on the corner. Left side receivers go down. Take their defenders off because it's man-for-man coverage, and you notice number 38 in the corner turned and ran with the receiver. Never even saw Lucas running the football. And with his speed and his size, he gets in that end zone.
Ray Lucas, an 8-yard touchdown. We'll be right back.
A 30% cut, that's the Whitman plan for taxes. But in the 4th District Senate race, both candidates take issue with her proposal.
I think that I owe it to my constituents to make sure that I study the budget that's presented next year before I can guarantee any tax cuts.
You can't run around and promise tax cuts when we have no plan. And that's basically what is happening.
Join Larry Stupnagel as Senator John Mathewson and his opponent Ben Lynch go on the record Friday at 8, Sunday at 12:30.
A day after word leaked out that McGuire Air Force Base is on the Pentagon's list of targeted military base cutbacks, New Jersey lawmakers are gearing up for a battle.
Very active today. You can see the spiraling bands coming in counterclockwise around that area of low pressure to our south. Very windy conditions.
What a moment for Ryder College basketball. First year in the Northeast Conference, we get the automatic bid.
I'd say I watched the replay again. I can't believe it still happened.
This is NJM, the New Jersey Channel. WNJS, Camden.
With 107 left to play in the third quarter, Rutgers leading 55-0. John Benestad kicks off. Atwater on the 9-yard line. He gains 10 out to the 19. Tackled by Mike Russell. Tell you what, that Temple Owl making it tough. 55 push-ups done by those Scarlet Knight cheerleaders. And Atwater shaking up on that play. Damon Atwater.
There's a guy that's anxiously waiting to get an opportunity, Pat. A lot occurred with him this week.
Nick Sheremeta, who had one punt against Penn State, took over the number one role. And Coach Graber decided that they'd give Sheremeta a chance. And with that, by demoting David Lippitz, Lippitz left the football team. He's still in school, but Lippitz, of course, had a punt blocked against Penn State, returned for a touchdown, and then gone off and shanked the next punt try. So Sheremeta, the new Rutgers punter, as Damon Atwater has helped off. Bob, how about a few football memories on this night?
Yeah, we've been taking a lot of memories this year. Here we are, October 2nd, 1976. The Scarlet Knights defeated the Big Red of Cornell 21-14. This led to an 11-0 season under Rutgers coach Frank Burns. It was a great year for Rutgers football, a great year for Frank Burns and his staff. And that was October 2nd, 1976.
Great year for Rutgers, of course. The basketball team going to the Final Four that year is Barry Williams is dropped before he can get going. Mark Washington up from the Rutgers secondary to make the tackle. Washington a part of that Rutgers tough package where they bring in those six DBs. Ray Lucas, who took a whack, Bob, in scoring that 8-yard touchdown.
Well, that's the thing you worry about. You want him to do these things, but you don't want to expose him. But he's hanging in there. He's 6 of 10 for 53 yards throwing the football tonight. And he's also run one in for a score.
Burris nearly intercepted by Mark Washington. Intended for Davidson. Burris has a gun.
Burris has a gun, but he's in a tough situation. You're trailing 55-0. They know you got to eventually put the ball up. Rutgers is coming with six defensive backs, so he's just got to find that open man.
Well, there's a good look at Rutgers quarterback Frank Edgerly. He may be coming in here in the fourth quarter as we have 20 seconds left now here in the third period. Burris winds up. This time it's intercepted by Sean Smith, the senior from Oakland.
But
Did he extend, Bob? Excuse me.
Excuse me. Randy Kanzader, number 16, was the intended receiver as he came down the sideline here. You'll see it. He's on the top of the screen to the left. As he comes down here, he's trying to hit him deep is Henry Burris, number 14, the quarterback for Temple. As he sets up here, he launches this thing. Sean Smith sitting in half coverage. He's got that half of the field. He just comes up, makes a play on the football. Big interception for the senior out of Indian Hills High School.
So now here's Edgerly at quarterback, handing off to Julius Blackwell. And Blackwell, a senior from Jackson, New Jersey, gets down close to the first down mark, but the third quarter coming to an end. 55 points on the board as they attend to Ray Lucas. We'll get a report on Lucas from Mike Mayock when we come back. You're watching College Football 93 on NJN, the New Jersey Channel.
World-renowned chef Jacques Pepin returns with an all-new assortment of light, healthy menus on the second season of Today's Gourmet. Jacques prepares mouth-watering recipes, low in fat but full of flavor. He'll demonstrate traditional techniques and update classic dishes, bringing you a delectable array of foods and flavors from all over the world.
So join me for the new season of Today's Gourmet. Happy cooking!
Weeknights at 5:30 here on NJN.
Whenever I want to catch up what's going on in New Jersey, I just watch NJN.
NJN is definitely the New Jersey channel.
Keeps us up to date on local news, state government, sports, and it is the New Jersey channel.
What would you do without NJN?
This is Scandinavia. But this is Scandinavia, too. Summer doesn't last long near the Arctic Circle, but when you live in the lands of the midnight sun, you learn to make the most of it. Visit Scandinavia, lands of the midnight sun, next time on Nature.
Monday at 8.
Quick update on Ray Lucas for you. He banged his shoulder up, but according to the trainers, no problem with next week. They're going to take some preliminary precautionary by putting the ice all over it. They're going to keep him on ice all tonight, but he'll be fine next week for BC.
Well, there is Rutgers quarterback Ray Lucas bundling up. And Frank Edgerly out of Wall Township and Red Bank Catholic High School in at quarterback now for the Scarlet Knights. And the tough going up front for the Scarlet Knights, number 30, Tom Wright, as Doug Graver is clearing the bench, as they'd say.
All Doug Graver wants to do is see that clock run down. Get out of here and let's go work on BC.
Rutgers about to go 1-0 in Big East play. That will be the measure of their success this year, their performance in Big East competition. Here's Blackwell, Julius Blackwell. Well, the numbers have been very impressive. Aside from the 55 up on the scoreboard for Rutgers, the total offense, staggering.
537 yards in three quarters. That's mighty, mighty impressive. Using two quarterbacks, variety of running backs, and a lot of receivers.
361 yards rushing. Rutgers now sends Earl Simmons, number 15, out to the right as a wide receiver. Edgerly hands off to Blackwell. And Blackwell stays on his feet, gets down to the 22-yard line. Marcus Counts makes the tackle. Tell you what, Bob, you can tell that Frank Edgerly is enjoying this time. He gave one of the best play-action fakes of the year as he handed off to Blackwell.
All right. Julius Blackwell, the senior out of Jackson, New Jersey, getting a chance to play here. Played a little bit last week late in the fourth quarter against Penn State. Another guy who's been in the program, has really given of himself, and now he's got a chance to carry that pigskin.
He gained 5 yards on first down. Blackwell again. Moving forward, tackled by Marcus Counts. Counts Bob, it's a tough situation as we look at Blackwell ISO'd here.
5'7", 188 pounds. Get the ball deep to him, and he's always looking to cut it back here. This time, however, Perry comes up, and Junius Counts comes up to make the hit just before he can make the cut.
He gained three. It'll be third and two. Edgley dropped the snap. Took advantage of an AstroTurf bounce and was tackled by Tim Terry as he got to the 20. Pat Gorman in at center now.
That's an exchange. It's probably because two guys haven't worked that much together. Edgley, the quarterback, who doesn't get many snaps in practice. And, of course, Pat Gorman, who's moved over, the sophomore, because of the injury to John Bleich at center. He's moved up to back up Kareem Williams. So the two of them are in there.
Pat Gorman, the sophomore from Mullica Hills. Edgley pitching to Blackwell on fourth down. Julius. And I don't believe he got there. Shedrick Perry, a sophomore from Detroit, number 50, making the play for Temple.
That's a great effort by that Temple crowd. You think they're down 55-0. They played that like it was the most crucial down of the game. And they played hard, and they stopped Rutgers.
Now, Ron Dickerson said, you know, as I go through the films, I'm looking for positives. He said, you can drive yourself crazy looking for the negatives, but we've got to try to come through with the positive reinforcement for this young team. 18-2, true freshmen, 27 first-year players playing against BC last week. Had a great recruiting year. Is hoping that the building blocks have been laid for success. Burris across the middle. Incomplete. Mark Washington broke it up. Intended for Tim Israel.
Ron Dickerson, as we said earlier, has paid his dues. He was an assistant coach at places like Kansas State, his alma mater, Louisville, University of Pittsburgh. He comes from Coriopolis, Pennsylvania, very close to Mike's hometown.
Mike Mayer?
And he was an assistant at Colorado. Of course, had spent a lot of time at Penn State. Joe Paterno is probably the one guy he admires the most. And finally, as you mentioned, defensive coordinator at Clemson.
Burris pitching to Culbreth. And it looks like Temple will maintain possession. Yes, they do. That'll bring up third down. Eugene Culbreth, number three. Running from the tailback spot.
Just a toss sweep here, following the fullback to the right side. Makes a great move there to get away from from the penetration, gets upfield, gets enough to keep this drive going.
Number 72, Ed Bowen, freshman from Staten Island, recovered the ball. Third and five, Burris in the flat, intended for Jeff Frederick. That ball is incomplete.
They talk about Henry Burris, and they say he's got the ability. It's just that he's young and inexperienced. But for Ron Dickerson to go out to Oklahoma and be able to recruit a talented youngster like this, this is part of the program, as we said before. Without making excuses, you got to start building somewhere, and that's what Temple's going to do. They're going to have to be patient, give him a chance to get his players, the kind of players he wants in his program, and what he expects of them.
Shea's punt, Funderburk backing up to the 30. Reggie Funderburk gets across the 40 down to the 42-yard line. A 46-yard punt for John Shea. So we'll take a break and return to Giant Stadium, where the Scarlet Knights are holding a 55-0 lead over Temple.
NJN is rapidly becoming a leader in instructional television. Through our Educational Services Division, NJN is not only in your home, but in the classroom, too. New Jersey educators look to NJN for a wide range of educational resources to enrich their students' learning experiences. Our daytime schedule offers over 100 instructional series in all subject areas for school-aged children. There's college credit telecourses used by more than 20 colleges throughout the state, and we're dedicated to adult literacy programming. Other educational services include distance learning. We're part of a satellite educational resources consortium, which delivers live interactive courses via satellite. Learning Link, New Jersey, is an online computer service for educators and instructional television fixed service, a point-to-multipoint distribution system. We're New Jersey's own public television, and we're dedicated to serving all your educational needs. Come learn with NJM.
Welcome back to Giant Stadium. Pat Scanlon, Bob Cassiola, and Mike Mayock. Rutgers leading 55-0. Ray Lucas, strained back. Now at quarterback, number 14, Scott Howell. Excuse me, that's Darryl Buffington, number 18.
Excuse me. I led you astray there. I thought it was 14 that was in the game. It's tough when you get at this stage of it to find out where these guys are coming from. But Darryl Buffington, there he is.
Redshirt freshman from Norwich, Connecticut. The latest, the fourth quarterback. Rutgers is 9 running backs, one of whom is Julius Blackwell. Blackwell picks up a first down into Temple territory, down to the 45-yard line. John Swift, freshman from Mannheim, Pennsylvania, made the tackle. Now Buffington went to Norwich Free Academy. Redshirted last year. Threw a touchdown pass in the spring game. First and 10. And Doug Graver keeping it on the ground.
Temple defensively hitting them. They're hanging in there.
There's Tom Wright. Everybody getting a chance for the Scarlet Knights tonight. Now second and 7. Up to Blackwell, he'll bounce outside. Julius Blackwell, very close to a first down. Brought down by number Mike Williams, number 9.
That's
Chris
a great,
Brantley, yeah.
That's a great shot of Chris Brantley. He's had a great night. Two more TDs to add to that. The 5 he had coming into this game, so he's got 7 for this season, and he's an all-time scorer from that position.
And he knows how to play to the camera as well. Able to enjoy a few moments. Third and 1. Buffington will keep and pick up the first down. So the Scarlet Knights pick up the first down. Keep that clock going. Keep those chains moving.
You bet.
Rutgers with its 31st first down. Statistician John Lombardi's pencil is overheating. Here we go now, first and 10.
We got a lot going on up here. We got so many new names in this ball game.
Buffington handing off. That's Tom Wright on the carry. While we have a chance, we want to tell you as we visit the booth here that we almost lost our statistician, John Lombard, a couple of weeks ago. Bill Friel, our spotter. John's wife, pregnant. And John, we almost lost you a couple of weeks ago, but great to hear you and his wife, proud parents now, the baby girl. Congratulations.
Now get back to your pencil, John.
Here's the handoff. Buffington keeps it on the ground to Tom Wright. Here's Bob. along with John, Bill Friel also working overtime tonight, and a fine job of spotting for us, Rich Freesia, other statistician.
We're all getting their work in tonight. Here we go.
Third and four, ball on the Temple 27. Darrell Buffington, a quarterback for the Scarlet Knights. Deep pitch to Blackwell. Julius Blackwell. First down, Rutgers, down to the 19-yard line. T. Lang Lloyd on the stop, a freshman out of Willingboro.
Hey, there's a great name, 73, Theokas, at left tackle.
Michael Theokas getting a chance to get some action at the offensive line for Doug Graber. Mike Theokas is Father Charlie, the former athletic director at Temple. Blackwell juking his way down to the 12-yard line. Bob, we go back to the importance of this game. We talked about it at the outset. First Big East game as we look at Mike Theokas.
Mike is a big one.
Doug Graber said coming in that this is what our season's all about, the Big East Conference. We've got to take care of business against Temple. We're 1-0, and now he can think about Boston College coming in. And a lot of Rutgers players have been looking forward to playing Boston College as Wright carries inside the 10. Very close to a first down.
Well, they are looking forward to him because of what happened last year in that opening game up at Chestnut Hill.
As we see our updated Big East standings, Miami at 2-0, West Virginia with a win over Virginia Tech. BC now at 2-1 off that upset of Syracuse, and Rutgers about to go to 1-0. Virginia Tech 1-2, and wow, Syracuse, Temple, and Pittsburgh looking for their first wins of Big East play. First and goal from the 9. Darrell Buffington trying to direct this Rutgers scoring drive. The handoff to Wright. He stumbles to his left. Gets down to the 7-yard line. Bob, getting back to that Boston College game, of course, Rutgers going up to Chestnut Hill last year and losing to BC in their season opener. At that point, Boston College quarterback Glenn Foley out of Cherry Hill disparaging Rutgers' bowl chances. And there are an awful lot of Scarlet Knights that have a score to settle with Foley and BC next week.
More importantly, Rutgers had a tough game last week with Penn State. They stepped up to play the big guys. They fell way short. Now they've got an opportunity to get back in and get back against the team that they have to beat in order to have any recognition in the Big East.
Here's the pitch to Blackwell. Julius Blackwell running hard. He gets in for the touchdown. Senior Julius Blackwell from 8 yards out. They
take
a touchdown from the right side of the goal line, Bob.
Yeah. Well, let's hear it. Here's the toss. Here's Blackwell just running behind his blockers, looking for the cutback. There it comes. Good balance there. He gets hit, breaks one tackle, two tackles, three tackles. Now he extends himself, and let's see if he has possession as he clears the plane of the goal. And he does. It's a touchdown. Great, great individual effort for that senior from Jackson, New Jersey, and what an opportunity for him to get a chance to play after all the time he's put in practice running for somebody else or running those other team players.
Eddie Duborg on to attempt the extra point. It's good. There's 62 on the board for Rutgers. The last time they scored 60 points, October 28th, 1978 against Columbia, when they shut out the Lions 69-0. Julius Blackwell the touchdown, and we'll be right back.
I'm Richard Lindley. I'll be bringing you the ITN World News with the top stories from ITN's own correspondents round the globe.
Michael Brunson, ITN, Westminster.
Houston.
In the city.
With the Arara tribe in the Amazon.
In the Black Sea.
Off the Piper Alpha platform in the North Sea.
Robert Moore, ITN, Baghdad.
Loch Ness.
And a French insurance story which...
At ITN's new London headquarters, a special editorial team deals exclusively with ITN World News. They assess the reports filed by ITN's correspondents for their importance to the world audience.
1-0.
In ITN World News, you'll find the stories that matter dealt with in depth. And in our daily special reports, we'll cover an aspect of the news development to give you the full picture, Monday to Friday. The ITN World News.
Exclusively here on NJN, weeknights at 11:30.
Well, 4:14 left to play. Rutgers taking care of business in the Big East, leading 62-0 as John Benestad kicks off. Fielded by Tim Israel. And Israel gets out to the 28-yard line. Let's go down to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Hey, Pat, my continuing quest to find anybody that'll talk to me tonight. I found my way up into the stands. Three high school students from Spotswood High School, big Rutgers fans. Now tell me, why would you paint the face and why Rutgers?
Team spirit, I guess. And it's just my favorite team, so I support them.
How about you, big guy?
Same as him.
Team spirit?
Yes, love Rutgers.
Love Rutgers, how about you?
Definitely.
Come on, give me something. Talk to me. Hey, who wants to be a star?
Mike Mayock having a tough time with his interview subjects as Henry Burris continues. Flag flies. Burris, screen pass to Danny Davis. And Davis, tackled from behind by Ron Keller, a redshirt freshman from Pine Hill.
Good effort by number 70, Ron Keller. He's a fine young prospect, very intense young player. At 6'4", 250, another promising youngster on the defensive line.
Offside Rutgers, that was the first completion for freshman quarterback Henry Burris.
Offside, defense, first down.
Ron Dickerson, his son Ron Jr., a rookie wide receiver with the Kansas City Chiefs. Going to be a tough year. Burris. Hands off. Frank Carter. Carter with a nice piece of running out to the 48-yard line. Number two, Frank Carter took a hit, and the young man from Deptford Township looked good.
He sure did. Great running in. Once again, Trometta is still waiting for that opportunity. He's got the ball. All right, just want to make sure he's ready if they need him.
I hope he's not reading the label, Bob.
If he does, he won't be there next week.
Here's Burris, pitch to Carter, flag flies, the play gets underway. Tackle made by number 71, Andy Gable.
Some really impressive numbers for Rutgers, considering that they've substituted entirely in this fourth quarter. Terrell Willis ended the evening with 191 yards rushing and one TD. And Bruce Presley had 103 yards and two TDs. 432 yards rushing, 176 yards passing for a total offensive night at this point of 608 yards. Stan Parrish, great preparation.
Parrish, the offensive coordinator, of course. When that guy makes plays like he does, you really look good. Here's Burris, looking deep. Broken up by number 28, Derek Ward, who was intended for Dan Latour. And Ward keeps the shutout alive for Rutgers. Derek Ward, a backup defensive back. Kingsway Regional High School, Swedesboro, New Jersey. Bruce Presley Also had a big night, got in the end zone for the first time this year. Got in there twice, in fact. Second and five for Burris. Screen. Intended for Davis, incomplete. Danny Davis, who led Ocean City to the Group 3 semifinals as a senior, rushing for over 1,100 yards and 9 touchdowns. Brian Forte got the start tonight. Enjoying Bill Bailey.
You're on, Bill. Smile.
Burris. Complete to Jeff Frederick. Frederick knocked out of bounds by Robert Higgins.
And there you saw the arm on this young quarterback, Henry Burris. He sets up. His receiver comes back to him on this curl pattern to get the first down. But he sets up well, looks left, and then looks back to the right and delivers the ball with authority. Well executed. Probably the best pass we've seen thrown tonight by a Temple quarterback.
And that tackle was made by Laquan Harris, a redshirt freshman from Elizabeth who also wears number 20. Burris, incomplete. Curtis Tribbett was tied up with Jeff Frederick. He would have had a chance at an interception. So Temple quarterbacks tonight, 6 for 25, 62 yards, and 2 interceptions.
Last week, Penn State ran that pass very effectively. That's that inside screen back from the wide receiver. That time the ball was delivered a little bit behind him.
Plenty of smiles on the Rutgers sidelines tonight.
They talked about reestablishing themselves tonight because they had to go back and find it both offensively and defensively, and if they've succeeded in anything, they've done that tonight. Not only in scoring the number of points they have, 62, but more importantly, the fact that they played hard on defense and played extremely well on offense up front in their offensive line, the blocking. They didn't lose that, and I think this is a very important win for Rutgers as they go to play Boston College next week.
Should be a good one here. 12 o'clock kickoff at Giant Stadium. Timeout, Temple. We'll take a break and come back to Giant Stadium. Malik Jackson, who scored a touchdown tonight. Rutgers up 62-0.
NJN Radio provides innovative public radio programming, including New Jersey news, public affairs, and world-class music, made possible by corporate contributions. As an NJN Radio business member, your company will receive image-enhancing on-air exposure every day for an entire year. To learn more about this exciting opportunity, call Susan Sands at 609-777-5033. NJN Radio 88.1 FM, forming partnerships for New Jersey's future.
Controversial testimony before Legislative Committee in Trenton today over a measure that would require educators to stress abstinence.
What does that say to your colleagues who genuinely believe that citizens of New Jersey have a constitutional right to carry these guns?
Well, that's why I asked for a vote on Monday.
Now, Atlantic City, Atlantic County have both declared a state of emergency. In Brigantine, there's been a limited state of emergency declared. We heard the governor earlier mention that the National Guard has been called out.
This is NJM, the New Jersey Channel. WNJS, Camden.
Rutgers up 62-0 as Temple on 3rd and 10 in Scarlet Knight territory. The only thing in doubt is the Rutgers shutout is Burris. Romando Davidson has to make that catch.
He has to make the catch. He was thinking of running before he caught the football. He had it for a first down, but he was going to take off and get in that end zone. And those are the frustrations you go through when you try to rebuild. and start from scratch, and that's basically what Ron Dickerson has to do here.
Well, Temple Owls have yielded 214 points in four games this year while scoring 45. Here's a look at some of the guys you don't often see. Number 77, Scott Vaughn. 52, Scott Pikochis. The offensive lineman in the limelight tonight. Here's Burris looking deep. Incomplete, intended for Wilbur Washington. Sean Smith and Curtis Tribbett were there for the Rutgers defense, so the Scarlet Knights turn away a fourth down try by Temple and take over with 2:04 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Bobby Sneathan, who had a big night for Rutgers. And Ron Dickerson with a smile on his face, still trying to encourage his kids, talking with Henry Burris as he came off. And Washington, the wide receiver, Wilbur Washington. Temple about to go 0-13 in Big East play as Darrell Buffington continues at quarterback for the Scarlet Knights. Handing off to Julius Blackwell. Blackwell, who was able to rush for his first career touchdown. An 8-yard scamper.
It's going to look great when his career is over and they see those final stats per carry. He's going to be very impressive. And 25 years from now, nobody will know the difference, but Blackwell will show it to him.
Before this evening, he had 11 carries for 49 yards, averaging 4.5 yards a carry. Tonight, Blackwell, 7 carries for 67 yards. Excuse me, make that 11 carries for 67 yards. There's the carry number 12. And that'll move the chains. First down, Rutgers. James Spears with the tackle, and here's another look at Julius.
188 pounds, takes the ball, looking for the seam, gets the first down. This is fun. He's enjoyed it.
I'm glad he is.
Yes, he is. You got to know what it is to spend all those hours never having this opportunity. And here you're being highlighted by Pat Scanlon on television.
And the executive director of the National Football Foundation and College Hall of Fame. There we go. Here's Blackwell. Take the handle, head off of Buffington, gets down to the 49-yard line.
Stay in bounds, though, Julius, please. Stay in bounds and keep the clock rolling.
47 seconds left.
Do you think Mike Mayock is chasing Bill Cosby's limo right now, trying to get an interview?
Or at least a ride back to Philadelphia. They'll go to the Under the Lights two straight Saturday nights to a high noon shootout with Boston College next Saturday here at Giant Stadium. Blackwell one more time stood up and gets forward to the 46-yard line. Well, Bob, Dead Graber, I think he accomplished most of his goals with the exception of
no more plays,
five penalties early.
He's telling me just stay in a huddle.
As Doug Tolis coming off the field at halftime, he didn't want to embarrass Temple, certainly, and I think he's got out of his way here in the second half not to run it up. Nonetheless, Rutgers beats Temple 62-0 as Doug Graber and the Scarlet Knights improved to 3-1, 1-0 in the Big East. It wasn't long ago that Doug Graber remembered some painful moments when he took over the Rutgers program. And he can certainly empathize with Ron Dickerson. Temple falling to 1-3, 0-2 in league play. And Brian Forte got the start tonight at quarterback and got it done with a great rushing attack led by Terrell Willis and Bruce Presley. Down on the field now, let's go to Mike Mayock. Mike?
Hey, Coach. Today we highlighted in our pregame what you had to say to your senior players with 4 minutes left to go at Penn State. Okay, why don't you tell us a little bit about what you said and how you felt their reaction was tonight.
What we did, we talked to the seniors with 4 minutes to go about we had to look down the road, forget that one a week ago, because the whole conference schedule was ahead of us. They did a nice job this week of doing that. We asked them to keep focusing and to stay in focus heading into this game, do what we got to do, and let the rest of the season take care of itself.
All right, you pitched a shutout tonight, and you've got BC coming to town next week. Give us a little preview.
Well, I tell you what, with them upsetting Syracuse today, you couldn't ask for anything better. If our guys can't get excited for that type of contest here for homecoming, then something's wrong with their heart, because it should be a good one.
Hey, Coach, great job. Good luck next week.
Thank you.
Hey, Brian. Brian, nice game.
Thanks very much. I appreciate it.
Got a question for you. Been a difficult year and a half or so, okay? How important was it for you to come back, get the starting job again, and put up a lot of points tonight?
Well, I felt real comfortable all year long from the time training camp started. I'm throwing the ball pretty well. I'm just excited to have the opportunity, and, you know, I just want to make the best of it. I know I'm a good player, but we have tougher challenges ahead of us, so we've got to buckle it down and keep getting better as a team.
Do you feel like a year later now, you're a better quarterback? You're making better decisions. You're throwing the ball on time. You look like, to me, last year there was some indecision early, and it looks like you've gotten better and better each week.
Mentally, yes. I think I'm a much better quarterback mentally, and I'm throwing the ball with confidence this year, which is a difference. I struggled at times last year, but overall I just feel really comfortable out there. Outside of a couple bad penalties in the first quarter, and we had a new center, so the timing on the snaps were a little off. I had the ball and nobody was going a couple times, but other than that, we started to roll.
Tell me about your friend Glenn Foley. Now, I know you guys played a little bit together in a couple of high school all-star games. Glenn had a lot to say last year after they beat you guys. How big a game is this for you coming up?
I think it's a good game for the team, but as far as what Glenn said, no comment.
Thank you, Brian. All right, big game next week, and back upstairs to you guys.
Against the Boston College Eagles, and Brian Forte poised under center and during the interview session as well. 62-0 Rutgers.